Hey, this episode of the Majority Report is being supported by, in part, by Simple Habit. Simple Habit is a mobile app that provides a massive and diverse library of 5-minute guided meditations, and the Majority Report audience can try Simple Habit totally free for an entire week when you go to simplehabit.com/majority. Folks, you know there's a tremendous amount of evidence out there about the benefits of meditating. You know the anecdata as well as the data. That is what they call it, anecdota. Anecdota? Anecdata. Well, Simple Habit has over 2,000 guided meditations specifically designed for different parts of your day. And just about anything you might be dealing with in life, they have guided meditations for mindfulness, meditations for anxiety, for depression, or when you're having trouble falling asleep, meditations for when you're wanting to overcome procrastination, or when you have something important going on at work. Meditations designed for parents. Certainly, could have used a little more of that over vacation.
But anyways, quiet down, God damn it!
They have meditations also specially designed for different times during the day, when you're waking up, or on your lunch break, or when you've just gotten home from work, right before you go to bed. What I like about Simple Habit is that I can tailor it to the moment. Different folks trying to accomplish different things with meditation. Simple Habit is able to cater to just about anyone, regardless of what your goals are with meditation, or for someone like me with very little past experience with meditation. The variety of guided meditations on Simple Habit is what sets it apart. Simple Habit just won the 2018 Google Play Award for Best Well-Being App. It's available on iOS, Android, and web browser. Majority Report audience can try it for free for a week by going to simplehabit.com/majority. That's simplehabit.com/majority. If you're watching on YouTube, put a link under the video. If you're listening on the podcast, we have it in the podcast description. Check it out, simplehabit.com/majority.
The Majority Report with Sam Seder, where every day's casual Friday. That means Monday is Casual Monday, Tuesday, Casual Tuesday, Wednesday, Casual Hump Day, Thursday, Casual Thurs, that's what we call it, and Friday, Casual Shabbat. The Majority Report with Sam Seder.
It is Friday, May 3rd, 2019. My name is Sam Seder. This is the 5-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged of the Gowanus Canal, from the Gowanus Canal, the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today,
helping you,
Heather Parton, or you may know her as Digby, will be joining us on the show. Also on the program, to assess the future plans of former Fed nominee Stephen Moore, Andy Kindler will be here on the program. Also on the program, to impeach or not to impeach, and whom are the questions? Meanwhile, Barr's DOJ continues his assault, or the Trump administration's assault, on the ACA and on asylum seekers. Speaking of which, new emails reveal that from the beginning, the Trump administration had no plan and no way to reunite kidnapped migrant children. Meanwhile, Warren introduces debt relief package for Puerto Rico. Like I said, Stephen Moore goes down. The emolument suit gains traction. Now that they have standing, Facebook bans Farrakhan, Jones, Milo, and one or two others, I think.
Boo.
Right-wingers.
Right-wingers. All right-wingers.
All right-wingers. That's correct. The Oglala tribe, Sioux tribe in South Dakota, tells the South Dakota governor, "You're not welcome on tribal land," over the anti-Dakota Access Pipeline law.
Anti-protester bill.
protester bill. Yeah. Voter registration groups sue Tennessee for criminalizing voter registration. And Florida lawmakers add a poll tax. What's old is new, folks. Trump's new NAFTA is in danger. And you'll recall the BP Gulf disaster? Well, the Trump administration says, let's try it one more time. All this and more on today's program, ladies and gentlemen. It is Friday, end of a of another week during this era. And, of course, the primary is in full swing. We'll talk a little bit about the primary today. But on Monday, Dave Weigel will be here. He's been out on the campaign trail to give us a sense of what at least those voters who are engaged at this moment are talking about, why and who they are supporting at this point. All of this, of course, is subject to change over the course of the really close to a year. I mean, I imagine that, well, I guess maybe just a year. I was going to say, like, by this time next year, we should probably know who the nominee is. But it's also quite possible by this time next year, we will have even less sense of who the nominee will be. It depends on how things go. The DNC will be in Milwaukee this year, and I believe it's in June. So we're basically a year out from the convention, year, maybe 13 months. So we'll see. There was a Eric Levitz wrote a piece in New York Magazine that I'm not going to probably talk about much, but I would recommend to you just in terms of like the nightmare scenarios we could be facing, regardless of who wins, you know, going not just 2020, but 2022. It's unlikely, but that may be 60-40, maybe 65-35, I would say probably is where it is right now, that the Democrats will be able to take the Senate. Largely because there are two seats in the Senate that that are held by Republicans from states that voted for Democrats or voted Democrat in the presidential campaign. And that is Maine and Colorado. Maine, of course, Susan Collins is fairly well entrenched. Colorado, there's a pretty good shot. And then you've got to flip one red state, which probably, I believe, went for a Republican candidate by close to double digits, all the rest of the red states. You will also lose, probably in Alabama with Doug Jones. And so then there needs to be three Democratic pickups, which could be tricky. We're very far out. You know, stranger things have definitely happened. But we shall see. I mean, part of that is a function of the intensity to get Donald Trump out of office, and how that brings people out to vote. So we will see, going forward. Meantime, I've got some very good news for everyone. Mike Pence, he is the vice president for theological propriety in the Bush administration. Is that
the head of the Council on Moral Virtue and Guidance. Well, we need to start just directly giving him Iranian titles.
Right. VP means very principled.
Very principled. He announced yesterday in the Rose Garden, I think it was the Rose Garden, that the president will not discriminate against people based on their religion.
From early in this administration, President Trump has taken steps to ensure that the federal government will never, ever penalize anyone for their religious beliefs ever again.
Wait, let's go back and now let's play Donald Trump just to get a reminiscence from the early in the administration. To be fair, this was just before the administration.
Donald J. Trump is calling for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States, until our country's representatives can figure out what the hell is going on.
There you go.
Well, at least he admitted that they did it the first time. I feel like he's in trouble for that.
Right. I guess on some level he's saying, you know, since early in the administration, not at the beginning and not just prior to it, but, you know, relatively early in the administration. Play the full clip of Donald Trump saying this, because just to remind people of just how wretched.
Statesmanlike.
Statesmanlike it was. Yeah.
Donald J. Trump is calling for. Now, listen, you got to listen to this one, because this is pretty heavy stuff, and it's common sense, and we have to do it. Remember the poll numbers, 25%, 51%. Remember the poll numbers. Okay, so remember this. So listen.
What is he talking about, the poll numbers? I don't remember now.
I think he was talking about I thought he was talking about how he was polling at the time and what was going to happen after he announced it.
Oh, no, I don't know.
Or somebody gave him some, like, Sam Harris, like,
right,
supposed data about what Muslims really think or some nonsense.
J. Trump is calling for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States until our country's representatives can figure out what the hell is going on.
Now, I should say, he's reading this. So this is not a, this is a prepared policy and statement by Donald Trump.
I got a story from, this was, I think, around early December. Here's a story from December 14th, 2015. Trump hits a new high in national poll. The billionaire businessman surges to 41% after releasing proposal to ban all Muslims from entering the United States. So he was apparently floating it a little bit before this at probably other campaigns.
Well, there you go. Well, that's it was very effective.
They love it, folks.
It's why you got to do it. It's why you got to do it. Folks, you may think you don't need life insurance yet, but if you have loved ones who depend on you, you have to have a plan. I've told you folks many times in the past that upon the birth of my first child, I waited too long afterwards. I mean, I got lucky, obviously. Nothing happened to me. But
you're in good health.
Really, from day one, from just about the beginning of the administration, I should have, you want to make sure that you are in some way protecting your loved ones. You're a mom, you're a dad, your kids rely on you, and your partner who you're raising your child with relies on you. But getting life insurance can sometimes be difficult. Ethos makes doing the responsible thing easy. With Ethos, you can get covered in 10 minutes online and even sign up right from your phone. No pesky paperwork or pushy salespeople. Just choose a policy that fits your needs and don't waste time deciphering fine print. Ethos treats you like a person, not a risk. They work to make sure you have the right policy for your lifestyle and budget. They have a dedicated customer support team right here in the USA to help with any questions you might have. Visit ethoslife.com and click check my price to get started on the quick online application. Insure your life today by going to ethoslife.com/majority to apply online. Insuring your life and providing your family with financial security has never been easier. That's Ethos, E-T-H-O-S, life.com/majority. You're 10 minutes away from your estimated rate. Make sure your family's future is safe no matter what. Oh, and this is a great gift. I've done this for both my folks, and I may even do a round two, because really anybody in your life who, I mean, for me, it works just better with my folks, but if my great uncle was alive, this would have been a great thing for him. Everyone has a family member who always tells the best story. Storyworth makes it easy and fun for your loved ones to share their stories with weekly emailed story prompts or questions you never thought to ask. You know, as I read this too, it occurs to me I should send this to myself and make it for my kids. At the end of the year, you get these stories bound in a beautiful hardcover book. I mean, I don't want to read my own stories, But my kids in 20 or 30 years might. Maybe they won't, but maybe they will.
They will.
But
they
certainly will. I want, for my parents, it's a great thing. I mean, ostensibly it's a gift for them. It's also a gift for me. Storyworth is a great way to stay in touch and bridge geographic distance by providing lively discussion topics for the whole family. Learn about your relatives with questions that elicit entertaining, surprising, and sometimes moving responses. Then pass on the treasures to your children and their future families with a beautiful keepsake book. Write stories, upload photos by email, on the web, or in the app. Invite an unlimited number of people to receive them. Everything is private and secure. You control who sees your stories. It's also a great gift for Mother's Day or Father's Day. Strengthen your family bonds. Get to know your loved one in a whole new way with Storyworth. This is honestly, I mean, this is one of those things that I think I've mentioned this in the context of Storyworth before. Our ad broker will send a list of potential advertisers, and you go through them. And there's some I wouldn't want to do. Some I'm like neutral, and some I'm like I would do this. And not only would I do it, but then I just, before we even get the ads, I go and I do it, because there's no other way to hear about these things. And Storyworth was one of those things. Storyworth makes a great gift for Mother's Day. You still have time. You can do this super quick. You can head right now to storyworth.com/majority and you get $20 off. Storyworth.com/majority when you subscribe. That's Storyworth, storyworth.com/majority. Check it out. Also, folks, small businesses have so many different headaches, believe me. And
speaking as a small businessman myself.
There you go. Now, our businesses aren't quite Hello? That intricate. Hello. But the problem that keeps so many businesses from knowing their numbers is a hodgepodge of business systems. That's basically what we go through with our two different legacy. We have a legacy members thing, and it is just impossible to deal with. And having one system for accounting, another for sales, another for inventory, so on, it's just a big inefficient mess that makes it too difficult to know what's going on, takes up too much time, too many resources, and that hurts the bottom line. Introducing NetSuite by Oracle, the business management software that handles every aspect of your business in an easy-to-use cloud platform that gives you the visibility and control you need to grow. With NetSuite, you save time, you save money, and unneeded headaches. That's what I want. By managing sales, finance, and accounting, orders, and HR instantly right from your desktop or phone. That's why NetSuite is the number one cloud business system. Right now, NetSuite is offering you valuable insights with a free guide, 7 key strategies to grow your profits, /Michael.
Boom.
At netsuite.com/majority. That's netsuite.com/majority. To download your free guide, 7 key strategies to grow your profits. netsuite.com/majority. All right, we're going to take a quick break. We'll come back and talk to Digby about what the hell is going on. There's,
I Samuel Lincoln Seder, will get Heather Parton on the show till we figure out what the hell is going on.
There is...
Watch, and watch the YouTube numbers.
The Democrats are sending mixed signals.
That doesn't sound like them. They're usually very clear, concise communicators and leaders.
But frankly, I'm not convinced what the right signal or how you do one of them is. And we'll talk about that with Digby as well as some other stories. I don't know if she is, but we'll find out.
She'll know.
We got to take a quick break. Back in a minute. We are back. Sam Seder on the Majority Report. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Friday. On some Fridays, we get to play this little tune. Are you ready for some DP? Yeah. Now, so first off, let me just remind you, you can become a member of the Majority Report by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. You get extra content every day, and it's all commercial free. But let's play that song one more time. One more time, because here, this actually... Okay, that's the Digby song, which means that Digby is on the line. Hello, Heather.
Hey, Sam, how are you?
Now, I'll tell you something. Okay, I've been listening to the Mueller report. I've only listened to a couple of the chapters, several chapters. I'm still going through it, and I'm doing it the old-fashioned way, where like I read a couple of chapters and then I read them again, and I'm listening through them multiple times. And I mean, I know this is old news by now, but this is a way of getting into the Barr stuff on some level, and maybe anticipating that Mueller is going to come and testify, but. I still can't get past, and I think my audience knows where we've been on, you know, what we anticipated would, was going on with Trump on some level. I thought it was mostly financial chicanery, but one thing that sticks out with me in their mandate, in the Mueller mandate, was they say that, you know, we were tasked with looking for links between the Russian government and the Trump campaign. They found a bunch of links. And, though, which qualifies the links, that the links need to be go to a higher bar of coordinated work between the two of them, where they actually were involved in the criminal things that the Russian government did in terms of interference with the election. And then there's a qualifier. That does not mean if the parties are aware of what the other wants and are working in relationship to what the other does. And that, you know, I'm paraphrasing that, but that qualifier, I just can't get over, because I did not tell Matt to play the Digby song at any point today. He knows that I've booked Digby. He knows at one point I'm going to say, that's why we play this on Fridays. And then Matt played the Digby song. And he does that because he knows that that's what I want. And and I know that Matt wants me to give like some type of physical indication. Now, that's developed over time and whatnot, but that's what we're talking about there. And that's still sort of like really, I can't get past that on some level. And that's what I think makes like hearing, I don't think the percentage of people who have even read two chapters into the Mueller report, where that is quite there, and in this country, who consume the news even, I would imagine is somewhere down in like the low single digits. That's why Barr's whole game plan up at this point has been so effective.
Oh, I agree. I mean, he obviously spent, you know, a great deal of time thinking through, and in fact, probably before the report was even delivered to him, on how he could get past that. And the way he did it was by following a very Trumpian sort of strategy of just saying it didn't happen, that part isn't there, by basically backing up Trump's mantra of no collusion, when in fact what you just said, what you just described, is collusion. What Mueller explained in the report was that that collusion is not a crime, and that was not what they were looking for. What they were looking for was evidence of conspiracy, as you just defined it, you know, working with specifically the Russian government. I mean, that wouldn't even be working with WikiLeaks or working with some cutout that the Russian, like, you know, Goldstone and, you know, the Agalarovs or whatever that aren't, you know, directly associated with the Russian government. So it's collusion. Of course it's collusion. We saw it in real life. I mean, Trump stood before a, you know, group of reporters and said, Russia, if you're listening, you know, please hack Hillary Clinton's emails. I mean, it couldn't be more obvious that he was welcoming it, that he was thrilled to have it, that he was, you know, in the waning days of the campaign saying, I love WikiLeaks over and over again, celebrating the hacking of his rival's campaign and campaign chairman. So we knew that he colluded, and Mueller, you know, validated that in the report. So, you know, that's really not a mystery. What is a mystery is why the Republicans and half the country, apparently, or 40% of the country, thinks that's fine. That's totally cool to, you know, to be working, to be welcoming the sabotage of your rival's campaign by a foreign government. You know, that I didn't know that was okay before, but apparently it is, and we've got people out there defending it and saying, hey, it's no big deal. This is just, you know, this is the way things are done, and, you know, anybody would have taken that meeting, the Trump Tower meeting. So, you know, here we are. I mean, talk about moving goalposts. I mean, this is a whole new world where we are now saying that kind of activity is no longer taboo. It's fine.
It's, you know, to me, it's, I mean, the activity is, yeah, it's problematic. And I don't know how much the Russian hacking and social media, you know, played in the outcome of the election. It's arguable that it didn't. But it's, what's clear to me is that, you know, Trump was not acting. I mean, I don't think most reasonable people thought that he was some type of, like, you know, sleeper cell for the Russians. I mean, he was a guy who wanted to build a building in Russia and wanted hundreds of millions of dollars, probably didn't think he was going to win the election. And basically his campaign kept doing things that Russia wanted, that someone like Manafort would know what would, you know, be amenable to them. And then Russia kept doing things that the Trump campaign wanted, knowing what they would want. I mean, these are fairly, you know, you didn't even need to necessarily collude in private, although there was obviously attempts to do so by the Trump team. But Barr has done, I think, I think to a large extent, in many respects, I think there is a criticism for the way that the Democrats have handled this on some level, but it's also partly is a problem of, like, you know, Mueller was seemingly, you know, thought that Barr was going to do the right thing here and just present his report to Congress instead of, like, you know, rolling it out 3 weeks after having basically created the narrative. And what I saw from Barr in the Senate Judiciary hearing was pretty stunning. I mean, this is a guy who was very, very good at not answering a question, but making it seem like he's answering the question. I mean, I think to people who are, you know, not carefully listening, it sounds sort of like he's answering the question, but he's not really answering the question.
Well, no, and he had, you know, I mean, he clearly has an agenda. He's setting forth a whole theory of this case, which is basically tracking very closely with the counter-narrative that's been set up by Fox News and by, you know, other, you know, right-wing operatives and coming out of the White House, which is that, and he said this in the testimony, you know, the president was unjustly accused of something he didn't do. And this had, you know, a.k.a. it was a witch hunt, and that it shouldn't have happened at all. But once it did, when Mueller, followed the rule, I mean, this is the most bizarre thing Barr said to me. Mueller said in his report that he did not come to a conclusion on the obstruction charges because of the OLC opinion that a president can't be charged. That would be unfair to have that, you know, that indictment hanging over his head for the rest of his term. But he did think it was appropriate to lay out all the evidence so that it could be preserved either for the future or for the Congress and the public to decide what to do with.
He said he wrote there are constitutional processes to deal with this. And that
exactly.
that's Congress is supposed to take a look at it. Right.
Yeah. I mean, of course. I mean, it was obvious the minute that, when I read it over that first weekend, I'm going, well, this is basically an impeachment referral. And it's the right thing to do because he obviously gathered enough evidence to prove that Donald Trump tried to cover up his crimes, whatever. And he didn't even, it's very interesting that in the report he says he may not have been trying to cover up this, a conspiracy, but there's a whole bunch of other stuff that he may have been trying to cover up, much of which Mueller was not able to get to because of the cover-up. So, this is, it was clear what he was doing, and that is something that Barr thinks.
And wait, I'm sorry, I don't mean to keep interrupting you, but I want to make it clear that that's what Mueller says. Mm-hmm. That Mueller says, I mean, every time, at least when they do their summary, every time they mention some type of what their findings are, he qualifies it by saying, but we know there is lying that we have not pursued and cannot
right.
pursue. And we know there's evidence that we cannot obtain that may change the outcome of this. I mean, so the obstruction clearly implicated their ability to find stuff.
Well, obviously. And we know that also just simply because there was a trial with Manafort. And within what we had seen from the court filings, they clearly believed that Trump's pardon dangling, which was obvious, it was in public and there's evidence that it was in private as well, that that pardon dangling changed Manafort's willingness to cooperate. And in that, as one of the prosecutors, Andrew Weissman, said in his to the court, he said, this goes to the heart of our case, which was about exchanging information with the Russian government or an emissary from the Russian government, this guy Kalimnik, who is also under indictment, by the way. He's one of the people Mueller indicted. And that exchange of information, of giving polling data, was at the heart of what they were of a potential conspiracy with the Russian government. That was that, and they were not able to get to that because of the obstruction. That's just one example that we only know of because should have been redacted in the court transcript, but it wasn't, and so we kind of found out about it. So who knows how much of that actually exists out there? But regardless of that, I mean, obviously, what Mueller was trying to do was what he saw. He objected to as a prosecutor and believed there was evidence there that Trump had committed a crime and was obstructing them from finding out the information they needed to determine the underlying crime. That's a big deal. This is the president of the United States. What William Barr is saying is that unless you clear the president, you cannot, that your only option is to clear the president because you can't indict him, right? But you also can't lay out evidence to preserve for the future or to hand to the Congress. He objected to that and believed that what Mueller did was the wrong thing, and he claimed he needed to step in and clear the president because that's the only option under this ruling by the Office of Legal Counsel that says that you can't indict a president, meaning that you can only, if you do an investigation like this, you can only clear him. He made a statement saying that, we've got to stop weaponizing the criminal justice system for political purposes or something like that, which is hilarious considering that, Trump's crowd screamed lock her up at the drop of a hat. But, nonetheless, he has this very odd theory here that any investigation of a president can only clear him, and taking that one step further into an authoritarian realm I can't even believe an attorney general would say, he says that if the president believes that he's being unjustly accused, he has a right to shut down that. My God.
It's stunning, the stuff that came out that day, and I think that's why there's been these calls, And I also understand why the House basically said we need to bring in a lawyer because of the way that that he
He's
answered.
That good.
Let's, all right, let's play this Coons thing first, okay? I want to play a couple of clips because the second clip I want to play is part of we played yesterday. Michael was hosting the show. He played part of the Kamala Harris exchange. There's a part of that Kamala Harris exchange that I think is like becomes more operative going forward, at least in terms of what we can anticipate in the 2020 election. But before we get there, this is just another example where Barr just, and this one just stood out at me, because here's Chris Coons trying to get Barr to concede that even though it's not criminal, or it should be an offense for a candidate, some offense, maybe not a criminal offense, but an offense, considered an offense, to take damaging information in the context of a campaign from a foreign government intelligence agency. Now, of course, I want to preface this by saying we're like undoubtedly engaged in this behavior in Venezuela right now. It's one of the reasons why I oppose the Trump administration, because I don't think we should be doing that. I don't think that we should have been doing it in the past. But if you say it's okay for others to do it to us, it becomes perfectly okay for us to do it to others. And so it has to be, you have to have some type of like parity here. So here is Chris Coons. And I don't know what Chris Coons' perspective is on what we should be doing with Venezuela or any other country, but nevertheless, here's Chris Coons trying to get Barr to concede that a campaign should not take information from a foreign entity. But Barr is smart enough after he sort of regains his balance to realize like, oh, this is narrowly tailored, so I'm not getting the president in trouble.
Going forward, what if a foreign adversary, let's now say North Korea, offers a presidential candidate dirt on a competitor in 2020? Do you agree with me the campaign should immediately contact the FBI? If a foreign intelligence service, a representative of a foreign government,
yes,
says, we have dirt on your opponent,
yes,
should they say, I love it, let's meet, or should they contact the FBI?
If a foreign intelligence service does, yes.
Okay. Now, Coons let him off the hook here, because you cannot do this. You cannot say, I'm going to give you the option, a representative of a foreign government,
right,
or a foreign intelligence agency, because that's what Barr heard. Like, oh, I got the option. I'll just say the foreign intelligence agency. Now, of course, if you say that, you can say, well, they didn't know they were part of a foreign intelligence agency. They weren't part of a foreign intelligence agency. They were just like a friend of a foreign intelligence agency, and they gave us the information, that type of thing. So Coons, you know, they were sloppy with this stuff in dealing with him, and that's why they needed a lawyer in there to get to Barr. But yeah, they didn't contact the FBI. And when you say should and they don't, like, that becomes problematic, right? That's something that theoretically Congress should look at and say, you know what? You're really not worthy of being the president.
The American people should say that.
Right.
I mean, this is just common sense that of course. And this was happening all over the Trump campaign. I mean, what did they come up with? I mean, it was like 100 different contacts, different people at different points, all throughout that campaign. And then, of course, we know how Trump has behaved since then. In fact, he just talked to Putin today for an hour and talked about the Mueller report. We're all in the clear. Apparently, he said, you know, they talked about collusion, everything's great, they're all happy. I mean, I think we can assume that at no point did he say, hey, you know, Vlad, bud, you know, no more of this interference. And if anything, he did the opposite and pretty much gave him, you know, a wink and a nod and a green light to do it again. Because there is no price to pay for either one of them, apparently, for doing this. So, you know, this is sort of an ongoing thing, and I think Barr backed that up. I mean, by being very specific, and he kind of struggled a little bit for a minute, and he heard that, you know, representative of a foreign intelligence service. I mean, that's pretty specific.
Right.
And of course, that's not what they do. They have cutouts. They have, you know, middlemen. They don't send over the head of the KGB or the North Korean Secret Service or whatever it is, and say, you know, hello, you know, we've got some information. Here is the papers. I mean, they have other people doing that. But the basic concept that it is wrong for you to welcome the sabotage of your, we're not just talking about the social media campaign. That's kind of a propaganda campaign. It's almost in a different category. The hacking is the thing that they can't right. ever seem to really address. And the hacking, which is the stealing of information and using it to sabotage your rival's campaign, is really not any different than the Watergate break-in, where they broke into the Democratic National Committee to, you know, look for information, put bugs into the phones, and they got caught. This is not ethical behavior. Let's just put it that way. And the idea that they're just sort of brushing that off as if it's no big deal is, obviously they're giving a green light for it to happen again. And I'm always curious about the fact that these Republicans automatically assume it's going to benefit them. And, you know, I mean, do they have assurances of that? Do they somehow know that they're going to be the beneficiaries? Because it seems to me they should be a little concerned. What happens if somebody does it for the other side? I mean, they would scream holy hell if that happened to them. But this is a very, this is a very weird moment in our...
I don't think they have much to fear, frankly. Look, we have emails from the Trump administration today that talk about, and I don't want to jump ahead here, but that talk about how they had no plan to reunite kidnapped children, migrant cat, and we're not going to hear much about it at all. I mean, the fact is that our media system is much more, and frankly, the nature of the support for the two parties is very different. And this type of information is just simply not as damaging to the Republicans. I mean, what could we have found out about Donald Trump that would have shook his supporters? Right?
Well, I mean, like, that's really the difference between, and that's why the Republicans don't worry about this. And it's really very depressing and distressing. This kind of stuff has been revealed, right? I mean, you've got this miscreant in the White House and completely unfit president. You've got now an attorney general that's engaged in a cover-up, and when you go and look at his past behavior, he covered up the Iran-Contra scandal. He, you know, sicked the Department of Justice when he was attorney general before in Little Rock, Arkansas, to go against Bill and Hillary Clinton during that election to try and help Bush Sr. win re-election. He lost, of course. But, you know, this is the kind of guy he is. We see it. Everybody knows there, and they're all cheering on that side. The difference is this, and it has to do with the two different parties, not the politicians who, you know, they're politicians, right? They're going to do what they do. It's the voters. Republican voters are fine with this stuff. They are absolutely win by any means necessary. They do not care. The Democrats would police themselves. They would not allow that to happen, and I'm talking about the voters. The Republicans can count on the fact that if the shoe were on the other foot, that Democratic voters would turn on their own, and they can count on the fact that when it's happening to them, that the Republican voters will stick with them. It's just not the same thing. Now, it's true that there's always sort of these partisan flows back and forth, you know, on what side you're on and what have you, but I remember scandals going all the way back that, you know, and you only have to look at what the scandals have been since, say, Watergate, that the Republican scandals have been humongous. I mean, we had Watergate, we had Iran-Contra, we've got this one. These, you know, we had George Bush in the 9/11 and the Iraq War, for crying out right. loud. I mean, these are people who push the limits. You know, Clinton, we had, you know, this Picayune stuff in Arkansas and this affair. We had Solyndra and Fast and Furious and Benghazi in the Obama administration. These were things that were, you know, patently made up scandals. And, you know, I remember when Clinton got caught with literally with his pants down with Lewinsky. They went to the floor of the Senate and the Congress, and they condemned him, and they said it was wrong, and, you know, all the Democrats did. No, they didn't vote to impeach him and kick him out of office. But they didn't just sit back and go, yeah, well, you know, that's the way it's done, you know, no big deal. And the public, they supported Clinton, but they didn't approve of him. And here you have Republicans that they absolutely love Donald Trump. They think he's terrific, everything about him. They, you know, they can't find a thing. And so they know they're safe in doing this because they're own voters. I mean, I hate to condemn, you know.
No, but that's right. I think that's exactly right. I mean, look at, listen, I mean, try and think of the analogy of the Clinton emails that came out, right, that showed disdain for Bernie voters and stuff like that.
Right.
Okay, try and think of the analogy where Donald Trump calls Ted Cruz's wife ugly or whatever it was that he said, exactly. Right? And like Ted Cruz himself is up there talking into the camera like, ah, this guy, I'm going to, and then, you know, 3 weeks later, he's like, I love him. I mean, it's like, and you know, where were the Ted Cruz voters? You said like, we're going to hold it. We're not going to ever vote for this guy. I mean, there were, Chaffetz was like, I can't look at my daughter in the eye, you know, and then literally like, he's invoking his teenage daughter as why he can't support Trump. And within weeks, he is supporting Trump. And so there is no analog here. And so that's why I think that the Republicans have a structural advantage with this. Mm-hmm. It would be like, yes, go ahead. You want to get China to break into Donald Trump's servers? Go ahead. It ain't going to make a difference because he knows that he can. And I will say this about Barr. And let's play this. Let me say this and then we'll play this clip with Kamala Harris because it leads into sort of like where 2020 is going. Barr is. And maybe it's because there hasn't been, you know, I haven't been able to see campaigns in the same way, maybe in 2018 as we saw with Trump. But Barr and Kavanaugh, it seems to me, are two very much post-Trump performances insofar as they just got up there. Kavanaugh a little bit more nakedly so. I don't think Kavanaugh has, frankly, Barr's intellect when it comes to answering questions, frankly. I mean, I don't think he's remotely close. But Barr also knew that he had, you know, this was not a confirmation hearing. This was like, you can't touch me already. I'm already there. But they both sort of did stuff and nakedly avoided questions or lied about stuff where you had the sense that everybody in the room knows this. Right. Everybody in the room knows he's lying or he's just being evasive and nobody seems to care. It's just this is the way it is. I mean, the Democrats showed a little bit more, anger towards it than they did under Kavanaugh. But there is no shame. That is no longer a leverage point. Here is Kamala Harris asking Bill Barr. So this is both an example of of Barr being completely evasive, an example and a moment where we're going to see what's going going forward in terms of what we can anticipate, where Kamala Harris asks Barr if the White House suggested the DOJ investigate anyone else. And here it is.
Barr, has the president or anyone at the White House ever asked or suggested that you open an investigation of anyone?
I wouldn't.
Yes or no?
Could you repeat that question?
I will repeat it.
Pause it. I mean, now look. He hasn't forgotten what the question is. He's looking, what is the word that I can hang my hat on? What is the flaw in your question that's going to allow me to answer this? So continue.
Has the president or anyone at the White House ever asked or suggested that you open an investigation of anyone? Yes or no, please, sir.
The president or anybody else.
Seems you would remember something like that and be able to tell us.
Yeah, but I'm trying to grapple with the word suggest. I mean, there have been discussions of matters out there that
They have not asked me to open an investigation, but...
Perhaps they've suggested?
I don't know. I wouldn't say suggest.
Hinted?
I don't know.
Inferred? You don't know. Okay.
What?
Huh. I don't know. It's so obvious, right? I mean, you don't even have to think, of course. I mean, Trump doesn't need to ask him. He tweets it. You know, he puts it out on his Twitter feed. It's like Michael Cohen said, you know, I mean, you don't even need a code. All you have to do is look at Trump's Twitter feed to find out what he wants and then do it. I mean, that's, you know, that's clearly. And Barr seems to be very willing to go down that road. He's made it very clear that he's concerned about, you know, the, quote, spying on the Trump campaign, that he's concerned about, you know, whether or not the investigation into Hillary Clinton's emails were handled properly. He apparently, I mean, Trump was on Hannity last week saying that he was looking, that Barr was going to handle this Ukraine story, which is the new thing.
I want to get to that in a second, but let me just stay with one thing about this Barr thing. It's not just that Donald Trump puts it out there and he knows in the same way that, like, Matt knows, oh, Digby's on. Sam is going to want the Digby song queued up, even though he never said a word to me. I don't know if I've said to the words to Matt, cue up the Digby song in months, right? He just does it because he knows that's what I want. But this also is an indication that clearly it came up in the White House. And clearly Barr knows it wasn't just a conversation one-on-one with the president. There were other people there that Barr does not fully trust that wouldn't tell this story. Otherwise, he would have just been very quick and say no. And so he's parsing this whole thing that clearly they're in a room with other people and somebody is saying, there's this Clinton thing. It was never fully investigated. That's why you'd have to grapple with suggest, right? Or inferred. Like, I don't know if you could say that's an inference that I should investigate it. This Biden thing's never been investigated. I'm sure Bernie Sanders has things that need to be investigated. There's all, like, every single one of them has investigations that you would expect the Department of Justice would investigate. Is that an inference or a suggestion? I don't know.
Well, we know how that's done because in the Mueller report, it's all laid out, these conversations that Trump had with McGahn, in which he was telling him to fire, you know, I mean, he didn't come out and say, fire, I want you to fire, you know, Robert Mueller. I want you to do it right now. He didn't say those words. But he says in a dozen different ways that he wants him gone and that he's not the right guy and that I want you to call Rosenstein and tell him, you know, that Mueller has to be gone and all this kind of stuff. I mean, this is how he talks. I mean, even Trump, as dim-witted as he is, knows enough to talk like a mobster and not just, you know, come right out and say it. And, of course, that's what happened. And you're right. I hadn't thought about that. But you're right, because Barr knows that other people were there, and this is the leakiest White House in history, and he has to be concerned that if he lies outright that he's going to get, you know, that somebody's going to spill the beans. And I hadn't thought about that, why he was struggling there, because it's easy enough for him to lie. And, of course, he is a liar. I mean, I have no doubt about it that he will lie. I mean, this guy is a rank partisan and has been for 30 years. He is somebody who, I mean, he predates Trump. And he has, you know, finally found the perfect environment to do what he has always wanted to do. There's no resistance anymore within the Republican Party, and the Democrats seem stymied, and the public is confused, and this is his moment. And there's a whole bunch of these people that are in there. And McGahn was one of them, by the way. I mean, he was packing the courts the entire time he was putting up with Trump screaming in his face. And pretending that McGahn was pretending that he was a hero to the press, and then in the Mueller report kind of comes off that way. But he's no hero. The guy packed the courts with the most far-right extremist judges you could find for the 2 years that he was there. He got the job done. So there's a whole bunch of these guys like that, and Barr is one of them.
Yep.
And he's going to be very formidable going forward because he has shown, he showed it back in 1992 when he sicked the DOJ on Bill Clinton. And didn't succeed, but he showed that he's willing to do that, and he'll do it again.
They're going to weaponize the DOJ.
Yeah.
And we already have a hint of this. And look, this, we're already seeing it with Biden. Biden, I think it's possible of all the candidates in the Democratic race, is my, my least desired candidate to win. All right. So let me put that out there. With that said, there's every indication that this Ukrainian scandal is total BS. And I'm only going by, look, I don't know much about what goes on in Ukraine. I'm going by the responses of this woman, Daria Kalinyuk, who is the executive director of the Anti-Corruption Center in Ukraine. Okay. And this other guy, Oliver Bulla, who is a, has written, literally written a book on Ukrainian corruption. And they're both talking about this New York Times article that, that talked about this supposedly Ukrainian scandal as being BS. And we know Rudy Giuliani is over there talking to the Ukrainians saying, if you revive this, we will help you. And
unbelievable.
And in fact, it was reported in the same story, I think, as the Times piece. I think it was the same story.
It was.
And
I don't know why it wasn't the lead of the Times piece. I mean, they did do a good job with the headline saying that the story was being pushed by Trump's allies. But then they go and lay out this whole, you know, alleged conspiracy. And then about, I don't know, two thirds of the way through, they mention that Rudy Giuliani's been over there trading government favors, apparently. He has no actual authority to do such a thing, but that's what he's done. In exchange for going after Biden's son, and you know, as a way to hurt Biden's campaign, it's right there in the story. And it's, I'm going, are you kidding me? I mean, that's the lead. And, the president's personal lawyer is doing this.
And there's no reason to believe that the Department of Justice will not go ahead and open up an investigation to give those charges more weight. And regardless of where it's heading, and the idea of like of Bill Barr being praised, and it, you know, you have all these moderate Democrats now. There was a piece out there who are like, oh, you know, on second thought, maybe Bill Barr wasn't such a good idea. and you know, not.
I laughed out loud when I saw that.
Here's the thing: the Democrats could never have stopped Bill Barr from getting confirmed, but. You know, creating the narrative around Bill Barr and creating the narrative is why Bill Barr got away with the 3 weeks that he's had to to mediate essentially the Mueller report. And so, I mean, the question now remains is like, you know, will Mueller show up? And they're apparently the judiciary is talking to him. I mean, this is how obvious the Bill Barr's sort of, I guess, sort of. Obstruction himself in terms of hiding the report from the country and allowing it to be interpreted, because everybody knows, like, I mean, I don't even know if anybody in this office has read the full report yet. And if that hasn't happened yet, then I'm quite sure the percentage of Americans who have actually read the full report is rather small. But here is Chris Wallace, basically chastising people on Fox News, his own network, saying like, seriously, guys, I mean, come on. Mueller is clearly not happy with Barr.
You know, I know there are some people who don't think that this March 27th letter is a big deal. And, you know, some opinion people who appear on this network who may be pushing a political agenda. But, you know, we have to deal in facts. And the fact is that this letter from the special counsel, and it was one of at least three contacts with the attorney general between March 25th and March 27th, was a clear indication that the attorney general was upset, very upset, with the letter that had been sent out by the attorney general and wanted it changed or wanted at least added to, and the attorney general refused to do so. He felt the attorney general's letter was inaccurate. He says in the conversation, he was talking about media coverage. That's not what he said in the letter. What he says in the letter is you didn't reflect what we found in the report. And there are a lot of people having read now the full report, or as much as it has been not redacted, you know, agree that he didn't reveal what was fully in the report. Again, those aren't opinions. That's not a political agenda. Those are the facts.
And so, I mean, that's Chris Wall. And so Barr has shown this sort of expertise at this stuff, both from a lawyering standpoint, but also from he understands the power he has as the attorney general with particularly with a party. Now, you know, we're 30 years out from when he did this with H.W. Bush. But the Republican Party has absolutely zero shame. I don't know how much they had back then. Maybe it was 5%. I don't know. Maybe it was 10%. But we're down at zero now. And the real question is like, what are the Democrats going to do about it? Right? Because, I mean, this is the problem. We have Nancy Pelosi getting up there saying he lied. But we're not going to impeach. We're not going to impeach Trump. We're not going to impeach. I don't know if she said it about Barr, but. And in fact, not only do we think these impeachment's actually too good for Donald Trump, but what's not too good is we're going to sit down and we're going to negotiate an infrastructure bill. Like the messaging here is so muddled. I just don't understand. Like, what is the theory here?
I don't think there is one. Honestly, I don't. I mean, they have this reflexive sort of response. That we have to do the nation's business. We can't be seen to be overreaching and doing all these things. I just this is just it's a holdover from a different time. And this is one of those situations where you can really see the generational problem here. People who fought too many wars in the past and learning the wrong lessons from it. And I honestly don't think there is a plan. Part of it is, and let's acknowledge. When you say that they have no shame, shamelessness is very, very powerful. It means that you can't use anything like that. You can't actually, humiliation, shame, any of those kinds of tools, which normally in politics are very powerful tools. They don't have it. So, you're kind of left with just purely using brute power.
Right.
You can't use it by, trying to get people to turn on them. Because let's face facts. It's not just the politicians who have no shame. It's their voters,
exactly.
too.
Exactly.
They don't care.
They don't care.
It's the evangelicals support Trump more than any other president in their lifetime. I mean, they love him. So, this is a shameless sort of faction in our culture. And at least political culture. And, this they don't have that tool in their toolbox, which to me means you have to use the brute power that you have. And I'm for impeachment. I think they should do it based upon the Mueller report. I don't think they have to wait any longer. There are dozens of other things they can bring into it. But once they get impeachment on the table, then the fight is clarified. It's real. It's not, putting up, eating fried chicken, as they did at the Judiciary Committee and putting up an empty chair and those kind of stunts, forget it. I mean, that means nothing to Republicans. They think it's stupid, and so do Democrats who are watching it are going, what is this? We have somebody who we think is a threat to the nation, who actually, colluded with a foreign government and is a criminal by all, normal standards, if you look at that Mueller report, in the White House, and you're, pulling stunts to try and get somebody to come up and testify, it's ridiculous.
And I would say, like, this, the refusal to show up, the ignoring subpoenas, the failure to provide information for oversight, this is all equally, in some respects, if not more so, damaging, right? Because now you're not just attacking now you're not just doing bad things, you're attacking the mechanisms in which bad things are supposed to be accounted for. And I don't care who it's going to be is the next president, or the president after that, or the president after that, or the president after that. If this notion that subpoenas from Congress are meaningless takes hold, if it's allowed to stand, to the extent that that we have seen anything that is authoritarian-ish in the context of the Trump administration, this is it, right?
Yep.
This is we're almost like in Star Wars territory here, where it's like the Senate just says like, oh, all right, well, what can we do? It's that type of like, this is how it would happen, where essentially the legislative branch loses all its powers by giving it up, by essentially just ceding.
It's a constitutional crisis is what it is. I mean, that is we say that all the time, but that's the real thing. I mean, this is a challenge and assault on the separation of powers. And Trump taking it even one step further than that, he tells people openly that he has the Supreme Court of the United States in his pocket. Now, I don't know if that's true, but it wouldn't surprise me. I mean, look what happened in 2000. When it came down to it, you saw what a partisan Supreme Court majority would do, right? I mean, they installed George W. Bush into the White House. And that was a totally partisan decision. They even said it, that you can't ever use this decision again in any other case. So would they do it? I mean, I think that's absolutely a possibility. I'm not resting my hopes on the court to bail us out of this.
I don't think that we're in a constitutional crisis. I think the Democrats are afraid. This is a game of chicken. And I think they are afraid of doing what they have to do because they're afraid of a constitutional crisis. And so because the constitutional crisis comes when they send the sergeant at arms to go arrest Bill Barr. And
right.
Bill Barr locks his door and has his, the Capitol Police that are protecting him or whatnot, stop the sergeant at arms. That's where the constitutional crisis happens. And I think the Democrats do not have the stomach for that. And so what's happening is they're ceding. The crisis is over and the Constitution is lost. That's basically what they're ceding this stuff. And I think it's extremely dangerous. And I'm not convinced of the political efficacy of it.
I'm not either. I think it's the opposite. Yep. Don't you?
I mean,
look weak. I mean, they look weak. They look like, I mean, look, it, you know, I hate to get psychological, but if you're a voter, I mean, we know that the Democrats, the base of the Democratic Party is not going to vote for Donald Trump, and they're not going to vote for the Republicans who participate in this. But there's a whole bunch of people. I mean, that may not be a majority. It could vary, not to mention the fact that the Republicans cheat. And here you have this group of, basic weak sisters sitting there. They've got a report in their hands that says the president is a criminal. It says it right there. They don't need to actually investigate. It's been investigated. They have the bill of indictment right in front of them. They could impeach the president tomorrow on obstruction of justice. It's right there. Now, would they convict him? Probably not. The Senate, is full of a bunch of, partisan, miscreants who probably would not vote to convict him. So what? They would have shown that they were willing to take action, use the power that they have, and who knows? Maybe there'd be some people in the country who would see this for what it is, which is, at least the Congress standing up for its own prerogatives and the Democrats having, as you put it, the guts to actually fight back. I mean, it looks like right now that they're just sort of flailing around, waving papers in the air and doing this. I mean, there have been some moments that have been effective. I thought Kamala Harris's, her interrogation.
But it has to lead to something. Yeah. It has to lead to something. Yeah. And here's the thing is that this is, we have a presidential election. The candidates can go out and offer alternative visions of what the Democrats will do in the future. But there are Democrats who are in power right now, who have some measure of power. They must exercise that power. The candidates can go out and make their arguments and say, this is for the House is dealing. I mean, it's sort of perfectly situated because we don't have many House candidates, serious candidates running who are from the House. So all the senators can say, this is what's happening in the House. When it comes to us, we'll, make that determination. Right now, I'm looking towards the future. I mean, it's so easy to do this now. And my only hesitation about actually voting on the impeachment is that I don't know if you get a second bite of the apple if God God help us, Donald Trump wins again in 2020. I don't know what the Democrats do in 2021, but if they don't have the Senate, then maybe it doesn't make that much of a difference. But regardless, what's fascinating to me is that we're running out of time here. We're going way long, but we had other things to talk about. But I noticed, Josh Marshall. Got into exchange. I just noticed it because it was with a buddy of mine, and got into just a brief, one or two tweet exchange about there's no point in impeaching them if they know that it's not going to pass in the Senate, which I think is the absolute, you know, I think maybe you have an argument again. Like I say, like you're using that arrow and you don't have it in your quiver. In 2021 is like sort of the full on double, triple break the glass emergency thing. But that, put that aside for a moment. Josh Marshall's the one who used to espouse, and I think even coined the phrase, the bitch slap theory.
Right.
And we're literally, this is the bitch slap theory. And, yeah. and Bill Barr is up there bitch slapping, the Democrats, and they've got to push back, because, you know, and not just by not answering his questions, but by not showing up, because, you know, there's a whole other slew of other things that they should bring into this. Bill Barr's not going to show up. We want to know how where he gets off attacking the ACA. We want to know where he gets off basically, you know, shipping, migrants, would-be asylum seekers who have, medical conditions or, issues back to Mexico. I mean, there's a whole host of things they should be talking about. And at the very least, they should be going after these people for attacking not the norms, but the constitutional procedures and laws.
Right, right. I mean, that's the very basic thing that we can expect from them. And, you know, I don't know if it's going to happen, Sam. I really don't. But I'm starting to feel a little depressed about it, because I kind of assumed that with this kind of bitch slap politics happening, that the Democrats would just, they'd have too much, you know, they'd have some pride and they wouldn't allow it to just go on. But I am really not sure. I mean, watching the performance, it seems like a lot of hand waving and not a lot of action. They have to use the crude political constitutional power that they have. Shaming and stunts are not going to get the job done.
This feels so much like 2003 to me. It's making me nauseous.
Oh God, me too.
Heather, I guess we get to do this again for another 15 years.
God. Yeah, well, yeah, I'm 1 foot in the grave already. I don't know if I'll make it, but yeah, well, this is certainly keeping me going. It's a fascinating time, if nothing else. I'll
Indeed.
Tell you that.
Thank you so much, Digby. We'll do this again soon.
My pleasure. Have a great weekend.
You too. Bye-bye. I'm going to need like 5 or 10 minutes here, folks. We're just going to have dead air. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, Andy Kindler will cheer us all up. Be right back. Sam Seder on the Majority Report, ladies and gentlemen. It has been too long since I heard this little ditty, and it brings me back to a time that will happen in like 30 seconds once we start that song.
With a Jew like Andy Kindler, you know you can't go wrong. His ancestors wrote the God Bless America song. A true Obama bot, Andy believes Obama can never be wrong. Yeah, AndyKindler.com. You made me laugh so hard, I had to write you your own theme song. Andy Kindler.
Yes, Andy Kindler.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Wait, but what are these
guys? Hey, Sam.
Yeah?
Sam, what's with the Pollyanna attitude around there? Are you guys going to send up a red flag? I'm so tired of hearing you guys say, hey, you know, the Democrats are a little slow, but they're going to, you know, everything is looking up. I mean, come on. Why don't you introduce a little skepticism into your worldview? Okay, that wasn't as funny as it was when you called me off air.
Yes, I pick up the phone and Andy's like, "Why so not? Why are you so cheery? Why are you so rosy?" And it's I kept yelling, "Save it! Save it! Save it!"
And then I get on the air, just like everything else, like every call. Here's me on every callback for every audition. I know you people think I can't act. I know that I've looked at the camera several times. I know you don't buy it, but let's take it again.
And what do they say? They're like, "Oh,
God." No, I'm self-deprecating. Look, don't you get it? I'm funny. I'll be good once we get the job. That kind of a thing.
Oh,
I'm telling you, Sam.
And does that
I'm
work?
Gonna jump off a building.
Does that, does that work?
No, I've never gotten jobs. I don't get jobs. That was for a long time. I would never look at the scripts. I wouldn't prepare.
Yeah.
I would go in there.
And how did that work out?
Holding the sides.
Yeah.
And then just say, "Hey, look at me. You should be casting me, not the me how I do with these stupid words."
Did you ever go in and you go, I should be screen testing you to see if
that's
I
right.
want to be in your project.
Yeah, yeah. The question is, do I want to be in a Milos Forman movie? Not whether Milos Forman wants me to be in his
now,
movie.
No, wait a second.
That's
Did you
I'm
audition
asking.
For that Andy Kaufman movie?
I have gone out for every movie where you can go out for it because the Coen brothers said anybody can submit, so then I submitted and then I still didn't get it. And I went to Milos Forman's actual hotel room with Francine Maisler, who casts his movies, and he had a new camera that he was playing around with. And
wait, when was this?
I was trying to impress him with my acting, and he said, "Hey, don't talk so much." That was my meeting with. That was my meeting with
wait,
Milos.
Did you
Forman.
Go to his hotel?
Hey,
his hotel.
Calm down.
His hotel room in L.A. Is it, or is it out in New York?
No, it was in L.A. I don't go.
Oh,
he wouldn't.
Okay. I went to his apartment in New York. He had a huge apartment on Central Park South. And I went to his apartment for the Andy Kaufman movie to play I think it was the reporter who ended up being played by Andy Kaufman's brother.
Jews audition.
Well,
there must be something about our type,
Jews
Andy.
Audition.
Yeah.
This was for the other one, The People versus Larry Flint. No, it was for... Was he People versus Larry Flint? I think he was. Right?
What was it? Was
Hello?
It? Yeah, yeah, he was him.
Yeah, he was the people. Yeah, I went in for the People versus Larry Flint. But my favorite thing is the fact that we should have known that things were going to be wrong politically from how they made the decision in that movie, because Craig Anton would have been the greatest Andy Kaufman. And Milos Forman let the studio decide between Craig Anton and Jim Carrey. And guess who the studio went with?
They went with Jim Carrey. I mean, that's
yeah,
pretty well
that's
known.
That's the problem. Where was
Wait,
the
Jim
courage
Carrey
from Milos Forman?
Where was the what? The coverage?
Courage.
The courage.
The courage from Milos Forman
you don't
to go a different direction.
It did not make sense. Jim Carrey did not make sense as Andy Kaufman there, right?
Really,
no,
very
you go in the movie and go, "Oh, my God. How am I going to look at him reading, doing Andy Kaufman? What is he going to read from a thing? This guy, this is horrible," I says to myself.
He should have had the same fearlessness that you have when you go after Chris Cuomo on Twitter at 3 a.m.
Hey, did you know this? This makes me laugh so hard. The first segment of the Chris Cuomo song, of the Chris Cuomo show, is called "Let's Get After It." It's not just what Cuomo says. That's the title of the segment. Let's get after it. And you know what? You know what the first segment of AC 360 show is?
What's that?
Keeping them honest. Keeping them honest.
Does it work?
Just like when he went through that guy's diary in Benghazi, right? Wasn't he keeping them honest then? Don't get me started on old CNN. Crap.
So who's bothering you the most lately? I mean, who is it?
Who sticks in my craw?
Yeah, who's sticking in your craw? Now, I noticed you retweeted a Chuck Woolery tweet. Have you seen this one, Matt? Does not matter if
he blocked me, though. I had to see somebody else.
Yeah, well, he blocked me.
It was Quilty, right?
Yeah. He goes, it does not matter if it took 400-plus pages or 4 pages. The conclusion is the same. Simply put, in 2 words, not Quilty. Accept it or not.
You know what? I always said, when he stopped selling lubricated catheters, I always said that was where he went wrong.
Yeah.
And you know, that one guy in that commercial, he says, I didn't know there was another catheter available. Really? Your whole life, you have to put things up your hoo-hoo, and you don't shop around? Good night, everybody.
Your hoo-hoo? Does that work on the road?
No. Good night, everybody. Hey, I'm falling and I can't get up. Hey, why 2K? Why not 2K? Am I wrong?
Jesus.
Hey, Sam, what's this with this Y2K? What's wrong? At midnight, your computer's going to turn into a deli tray? Good night, Phoenix.
Everybody in this office is just like, what is he talking about? Because they were all like 10 when these jokes were
your
big.
New staff doesn't fucking get... Oh!
I still get you, Andy.
I didn't know. Can I curse? No.
Yeah, you can. Sure.
You're less stoked get you than you used
yeah,
to be.
Yeah, no,
Andy.
You
they
and
don't
I are
get
both
me.
The same. You and
they
I
think
are
I'm a think dinosaur I because I hate Dennis Miller.
Oh, we all hate Dennis Miller.
I know. I'm just... Okay, I'm sorry. I just got out of that character. I'm okay.
It was
now.
At the Goodwill. I forgot it. I'm sorry. I should have kept track of it, but he had a Joe Biden enters the race tweet that really was genuinely one of those like, dude, what are you saying?
Who did?
Dennis Miller. It was one of the ones where I quote tweeted it with 3 question marks.
Wait, did I get blocked by Dennis Miller? Because I haven't seen any tweets by him in a long time.
Blocked. Let me see if I can find it. I'll read it.
To
if
be
I can
fair.
Find it.
That's what people ask. That's what they ask about his career all the time. Was I blocked by him or is he just not doing anything? Do you remember when Sarah Palin, this is a true story from the old days when we thought things were bad.
This one, may I read this?
She said she called him Joe because she couldn't stop saying, oh, Biden, in the warm-up debates.
Yes, I remember that. Oh, Biden.
Can I
read
you, Joe,
this tweet?
Because in the warm-up debates, I keep saying, oh, Biden.
Hey, Andy, if you'd still like to work out your 2007 Palin material, go right ahead. Can I read
think I'm
this?
On something. I'm like, on Adderall.
Hey, Andy's
sorry.
Like, I got something. Sarah Palin wasn't the sharpest tool.
Is this me? Are you doing me now?
That was you. All right, you ready for this,
hey,
Dennis?
Hey, Sarah Palin. Hey.
Sarah Palin was like Jim Carrey being Andy Kaufman, except it was vice president. Bad casting. All right. This is Dennis Miller tweeted this out on, what is this? March 2018. March 5th, excuse me, at 7:58 p.m. I just like a very particular time. Jar Jar Biden says Trump is a disaster. Joe Biden should be the third guy in the car on Sonic commercials. I'm already confused. He's
okay,
the
now,
blank
Sonic
square.
Commercial.
Wait. He's the blank square and asshat Scrabble. He's also, I think bottled water tastes better when you shake it, stupid, and shakier than a rescue dog in Phil Spector's house. This actually wasn't the one. There was another one about his hair plugs, but it was even more confusing.
Where's the beef? Where's the beef, Dennis Miller? Where's the beef?
Dennis.
I don't get any of those references. I thought Sonic ads are the one where you're supposed to like fuck the burger, right?
Oh, here's the, here,
there's
I'll just
guys,
read it.
Two guys in the front seat and they're very
I know,
funny.
I know that guy.
Go,
one of the guys.
A burger. You should have the burger. And he should be the third guy.
Pete Gross is was the guy who played, was the executive producer of The President Show. And he was also, he played Mike Pence on that show.
Oh. Is it those commercials, in the Sonic commercials?
Yeah. Wow.
And Phil Spector.
Small world.
I know he's a murderer, or maybe, right? But I don't know if he murdered dogs. I thought he was supposed to murder this people.
One. This one. I don't, and this one also has the hashtag Dennis Miller option. Yes. When someone, and I don't know this word, I'll confess. What is this word?
Pneumatic.
Pneumatic
wrench. Yeah, pneumatic wrench is like when you have an air gun.
Okay. When someone used the pneumatic wrench from the Indianapolis 500 to ratchet in Joe Biden's last hair plug, I swear to God, they went a groove too far. and severed the discernment lobe.
Wait, is our hair plug jokes really where you want to go in 2020?
Hashtag Dennis Miller.
What the fuck is a discernment lobe?
Dennis Miller, I mean,
it's called intellectual comedy.
Here, he also said just like 3 or 4 days ago, Biden just got his first union endorsement. It's April 29th. Biden just got his first union endorsement. The coveted Mid-Wilshire Corridor Cosmetic Surgeons Local 431 nod. That would no doubt bring
him. He's losing. Who could possibly understand where he's going with that?
No, I know where he's going with it.
He's calling Joe Biden a big busty bimbo.
That would no doubt bring a big smile.
I don't think people are
do his smile if he wasn't already perpetually frozen into a post-chemical vat. Joker Cheshire's yearbook photo. So...
Wow.
He's starting to get good.
Well,
you all have to admit, he's starting to come around to a whole another level.
Let's hope. So this is, and look, yes, I would agree. Joe Biden looks a little bit...
sexy.
Little bit odd with all the work that he's had done. But I'm quite sure Dennis Miller's not going to want anybody to break into his server and find those emails with his Botox. Because he knows where the corridor of cosmetic surgeons local.
No, to Dennis Miller's credit, and I don't know why I'm doing this.
I hate being fair,
but I saw a brilliant and highly funny routine he did years ago on the O'Reilly Factor, where he explained that the efficacy of his hair transplant showed that he took the free market option versus Joe Biden's socialist hair transplant.
I see.
So I guess points for honesty, but continued no points for funny.
It's self-deprecating. That's why it's funny. It's self-deprecating.
I mean, if I were Joe Biden, I would be like, oh, wow, thanks for the compliment. You think I look so good that I got plastic surgery? Cool.
I don't think Joe Biden's going to pay too much attention to Dennis Miller. I mean, it really takes like bottom feeders
I think we're going to need to give Joe Biden the basic props.
Well, maybe we can make a connection. It seems like Dennis Miller might have a thing for him.
Hey, oh, speaking of bottom feeders, we wanted to, because Andy, as you know, not only are you one of the titans of the comedy industry, you're also very well known for being... repeatedly hired over now multiple decades to assess the state of comedy as an industry itself. And so who better to assess the quality of jokes that Stephen Moore, the now pulled nominee for the Fed, the jokes that he's told over the years, because he went on Tucker Carlson was just talking about how everything he said was jokes. And then some stuff was sort of stupid. That
was
he said,
Bubba the Love Sponge? Was Bubba the Love Sponge on there?
But let's hear one of these classic jokes that, you know,
in the movie version, in the hacky movie version, I'm familiar enough with Bubba through Howard Stern that I actually could see Stephen Moore make like an earnings crack and Bubba just be like, hey man, it's 2008.
Yeah, exactly.
What are you talking about?
All right. So here is Stephen Moore. We played this clip earlier in the week, but it bears repeating because it's pretty stunning. I want to remind people, Stephen Moore is not just the guy who's not going to be on the Fed. He was on the Wall Street Journal op-ed board. He has been hired by the Heritage Foundation multiple times. I think he's done passes through there.
CNN.
CNN.
He's the president of the Club for Growth, everybody.
No,
please don't forget that.
He's not. He was working with Grover Norquist, who's the Club for Growth. Maybe he was.
Oh, okay.
He was a top advisor to Sam Brownback along with Arthur Laffer in the Kansas disaster. This guy has had a really incredibly oversized impact on our politics over the past couple of decades.
He co-founded and served.
He's been on TV since the 80s. He's been on TV since the 80s. Yeah. I've watched him.
He co-founded and served as president of the Club for Growth from 1999 to 2004.
Oh, there you go.
And that was the days when it was a real organization. Even more than that, Edward Haas, that guy Haas and his Council of Economic...
Right, and does
advisor,
this guy even have any credentials as an economic scholar? I mean, no, but here he is, ostensibly, and they're making it about, like, the liberals took me down, right? Like, as opposed to, like, The liberals don't have the ability to anybody down. Right?
He has a master's in economics from George Mason University.
Boom. All right. So there you go. And here he is on the firing line, which is, of course, that longtime liberal institution, the firing line.
Another statement that keeps coming to light is a joke he made about the Obamas. Just after the election, here, I'll play it.
By the way, did you see that there's that great cartoon going along, that New York Times headline, first thing Donald Trump does as president is kick a black family out of public housing, and it has Obama leaving the White House. I mean, I just love that one. But it's just a great one.
So, you know, that is
a joke my God. I always made about it. He did sell it well.
He wasn't even, you know what I love about that, though, is he's such a, like, weirdo that he wasn't even properly enjoying his own horrible, like, he's just, I just love that
no,
one.
He knew where he could tell.
Maybe he recognized midway through it that that was it.
I think that's
call.
What he was doing. He's like, oh my God,
understand.
What have I gotten myself into?
No, I don't think that's what it is. I mean, what's amazing.
You're right. I'm wrong. I think you're right about that.
What's amazing is.
He's not that self-aware.
He's not telling a joke. He's telling about a joke. He's not saying, like, I'm not, you know, it's like I'm not acting out Star Wars for you. I'm telling you I love the movie. And that's all he's saying. He's like, I love that joke. He's not even telling the joke. He's saying, I love that joke. And here's the joke I love. I mean, and so here's how he explains it, though, which is even worse on some level as he tries to explain it away.
And it has Obama leaving the White House. I mean, I just love that one. But it's just a great one.
So, you know, that is a joke I always made about, you know, Obama lives in, you know, the president lives in public housing. But I didn't mean it like a black person did. I just meant that, you know, being in the White House, you know, for example, when I was working with a lot of women and families who were involved in the education voucher program, you know, here in D.C., and people would say, well, you know, and these were blacks who would say, you know, why does Barack Obama black. Get to send his kids to any school that he wants to, and we can't. And they say, he lives in public housing. And it was just kind of a joke. And that
pause
was
it. But let's go back to the original joke where it says, kicks out a black family. And why does Stephen Moore say, and they were blacks themselves who said that it was okay to say this.
Do you think he's too dumb to understand that the original joke was a joke at Trump's expense, and that's why he's having so much trouble explaining it?
Yeah, but I don't, yeah, maybe it was a, it was
no,
a.
No, I think it's not a Republican joke.
It's Republican.
The origins, the first
They're
version.
They're proud of that part.
But no, Jamie's, I told you, the first, at least the first version of this joke was the roast of Donald Trump. And Snoop Dogg said, Snoop Dogg said, you should run for president. It wouldn't be the first time you ran a black family out of their home. So it was actually.
As a reference to the many times that he's actually done that.
No, it was literally, he was joking about him being a racist.
He was so
landlord.
Excited. Yeah, I totally missed that part. But I thought he was. Hey, we got a black guy out of public housing. Isn't that fantastic?
Well, no, but that's the thing, is that it was a joke that was originally written to embarrass Trump. And then they realized, wait a second, we got nothing to be embarrassed about. Yeah, we're talking about kicking out black people from their homes.
He's a black guy in public housing.
Right,
this is amazing.
This is great. That's what's so...
Wait,
that's
we
why,
kicked a black family out of their home. Where's the bad?
That's why Stephen Moore is like, that's one I really like. It's really good. That's why I like that, because it's one that they think that we would be embarrassed about. But now we're in power, so it's great.
He used to laugh maniacally. I don't know if he still does that. He would laugh maniacally in between whatever point he was making. So he's always been, I don't know, there's something a little bit off about that guy.
Well, let's go. This is the second part of this.
And what I was trying to say was that there are other people that there was something a little bit off. It wasn't really a joke about him.
Yeah, it was just,
I was saying that there are people that are off, and actually I was trying to say that maybe he could do his TV hits better and I could help him.
I think if we had more footage of him at that Republican function where he repeats that joke, he would say, and the reason why I think it's so great is because I worked with some blacks in the charter voucher program, and they would make a similar joke. And my point is that we're all the same, folks. And
those black pro voucher jokes that started with, hey, it's hilarious that Donald Trump, a white supremacist, took over Barack Obama after Barack Obama's presidency. And yeah. You know what really grinds my gear? The fact that I can't get a scam voucher to send my kids to a religious school.
Not to mention...
Classic humor you pick up in the commissary.
Right. Barack Obama, not even American, right? Am I right? I know, it's great how it brings us together.
It's not even a joke if it's just something that you're doing, right?
Exactly. All right, let's hear it. There's more.
I still think he would have been good on the Federal Reserve, though, right?
And they say he lives in public housing, and it was just kind of a joke, and that was
referring. The optics, though, conservative white man talking about picking a black man out of public housing have a particular resonance, especially in this moment.
Yeah. So I shouldn't have said it. Again, you can find, you go back 30 years, you're going to be able to find clips over and over and over again about me. I have a long paper trail. I mean, there's no question about it. And
pause it. I love the fact that he says, like, look, you could go back 30 years. Now, that clip you just played, that was 18 months ago. But
so good.
30 years ago, you could see clips of me basically, you know, wearing a hood. I mean, if you really wanted to.
Over and over and over again about me. I have a long paper trail. I mean, there's no question about it. And I say things that are kind of jokes that if people want to pick them apart, then I probably won't, you know, get on the Federal Reserve Board.
That turns out to be very, very accurate. Now, Andy, come on.
Don't give up, Stephen. Come on. Stay in there and fight. Oh, maybe I shouldn't be on the board.
That was the most astute, you know, as a guy who's supposed to be an economics forecaster, that was the most prescient of anything he's ever said. I've made a lot of really racist jokes, and maybe I'm not going to go to the board.
I want to make some distinction here, Andy, and this is actually sort of, I don't want to bring this conversation and make it too serious, but there seems to me society should have a different standard. There should be a qualitative difference between writing a joke, right, as a as a comedian, and it being like crossing the line, or it being you know, an attempt at humor that goes awry and it is problematic in some way. And I'm not saying that one should get a pass for that, or repeating a racist joke and then getting away with saying it was just a joke. I mean, if you're not a comedian or in the act of like trying to write and deliver comedy, I don't think you should get away with it was a joke. It's a racist joke that you're repeating because it's a racist joke.
In fact, you should
not, like, I made a joke that turned out to be a bad joke.
Are you saying, because I actually agree, way more room to make a mistake if you're actually trying to formulate a joke yourself.
Yes, that's
right.
What I'm saying.
Yeah, right. That's such a good point. Who's like, no, I just repeated a tired racist joke that somebody else said. Yeah. I wasn't part of the creative process at all. I just heard a terrible thing and repeated it.
I just had time to absorb why it was funny, to know the circles in which I would retell that joke over and over again. And then I repeated it and someone overheard me say it. I shouldn't be held. It was just a joke.
Not to mention they appropriated an anti-racist joke and made it a racist joke.
To be fair, I don't think Stephen Moore realized that.
They even fooled me. I'm one of the top comics in the biz.
I mean, it's one thing if, like, you make a joke that you think is going to be funny and it turns out, like, oh, I was insensitive, it's racist and this and that. I have time to reflect on it and this and that. I mean, I'm not saying you should get a free pass for that. I mean, every now and then if you do, you know, but the idea of, like, taking an existing
joke.
Like,
I'll give you an example.
I did was,
these are actual jokes when I heard when I was back in the 60s growing up. This is an actual joke. Can you imagine if I went out and I said, hey, it's like a joke where they said, how come black people got killed in Vietnam so much? Because whenever they said get down, they started dancing. Huh? That was marvelous, wasn't
that
it?
That was like the joke that that they would say when they were complaining about, you know, Obama not giving them vouchers. But look, anyways, if that's a problem, I'm not going to be on the Fed.
It's marvelous. I think it's marvelous.
But like, is anybody surprised? Like, does anyone think he's like impugning the good name of the Heritage Foundation by associating it with racism? Like,
no,
that's pretty much on the surface.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's true.
How about those Southern Democrats who had to explain why they were doing blackface? That's never going to come up in my life. Why was I in high school? I'll explain why I was in blackface, because I did a good backwards moonwalk. I mean, it really is literally unbelievable that these people are still alive, that are this racist.
I, you know what? We played The Birth of the Nation at family night, film night on a Friday night. It was just a film. We were all cheering.
Even Gone with the Wind. When I was watching Gone with the Wind as a kid, I was like, is this okay? This doesn't look good.
You know what I like?
This movie.
Could you imagine being, though, like, he's the one dude. Like, everybody else can just do whatever they want. And he's like, they're like, no, you're too incompetent. Nope.
Well,
nope.
Herb McCain is also like that. I mean, the fascinating thing is that they use the excuse of things like sexism and racism to take him down so that they're not blamed for, Jody Ernst was one of the big ones who was worried about the sort of the misogyny because she's running for re-election in Iowa and she's a little bit nervous. These are like the purplish states where you see the senators get a little bit nervous and they can't afford to lose those states. Now, the fact is, though, they did not want Stephen Moore because he's an idiot. And
wait, are you saying these people don't care about racism and sexism?
They don't, but they do like it when they can use it and get some points. They get some bonus points for seemingly doing the right thing when in fact they're simply doing it because they don't have the guts to go after to buck Trump on just sort of something that they know people don't care about. In other words, there's not enough sophistication and the left has failed at this, broadly, and the Democrats in particular. Stephen Moore should have already, there should be enough knowledge out there about this guy's economic policies that would have immediately excluded him on day one. That you wouldn't need to go to the fact that he's an out and out racist hack. And misogynist hack to sink him. But they would have lost that fight because there hasn't been enough. People just don't pay attention to that enough.
Well, because let's think of the old days about Reagan when we actually thought it was horrible that Reagan was putting in people in charge of all these departments who actually wanted to dismantle them. Right. Like the guy who was the head of the Interior, I think it was Watt, whatever.
James Watt.
I mean, that's like a joke. It's like a joke. Like maybe Orwell was right, I guess, if the Department of Justice is headed by Bill Barr. I mean, I guess it's so astounding.
Why can't black people swim?
It makes you paralyzed.
Yeah. Why can't black people swim?
P.S.
It's because of the extra bone in their ankle, and that was a joke that the black people told me because they were angry that the Democrats, who were mainly black, wouldn't give them money for their own religious schools. And that's about all I have to say about that today.
That was charming, the welfare queens riding Cadillacs. Wasn't that charming compared
to welfare queens,
complete Nazism?
The joke that I heard was from the welfare queens who were angry that the black leaders were giving them welfare instead of Catholic schools.
I was around with a bunch of black pimps, and they all told me this story, and we all laughed, and it was a great time for us all to come together. That's why I repeat that joke.
His name was Slim Shiny, and his joke was that the Democrats didn't want them to have more entrepreneurial schools.
That's right.
Which upset him and the woman who worked for him so greatly. And that's why I said they had an extra ankle bone. It was their joke. No more questions.
And
thank you, everybody.
Say, they would say to me, if we gave them a tax cut, they would pass it along to their Johns. And that's why you've got to have supply side.
And then they can go to the chicken shop and buy more things. And that's what they said. Anyways, as for cocaine
trafficking, let me do my joke about the
I know nothing.
Falling again.
Please refer to Bill Barr.
Hey, at least, but remember the days when Clinton was considered ballsy for going after Sister Soldier?
Well,
he was an asshole for going after Sister Soldier, Andy. We got to stick to making fun of Republicans together
Critical
because he was an asshole.
For Sister Soldier.
No, he was an asshole. Oh, did you think I was pro-Clinton? I was actually... Do you people think I'm part of the Democratic Leadership Council?
Yes. You're my favorite member of the DLC.
Do you think because I'm an Obama bot, I was pro-Clinton going after his sister's soldier?
But that, okay. I mean, that is, but that's funny because that's basically what Digby and I were talking about is that the structurally, the center to the left is just a lot less forgiving of things that could be revealed about that people try and keep secret or the things that people do wrong in that respect. As
they called him
be.
The first black president, Clinton.
Well, that's because he played the saxophone.
Because you what?
Played the saxophone and went on Arsenio.
Oh, there's the saxophone,
How did... God. I guess the 90s were a different time. I just don't know how anyone got away with that.
It was a different
time. With the Sister Soldier thing or just racism
were people,
or what?
Like calling Bill Clinton the first black president, like was nobody offended by
that? Oh, yeah. No, that was
bad.
Was
a black author who coined that phrase.
Doesn't
wasn't
matter.
Wasn't a white person.
I mean,
the ultimate new woke white
it was,
position.
It was.
It does not matter.
I mean,
and Chris Rock did a whole routine on it.
It's
too.
A very
different scene.
Different time. I mean, he got away with. I think partly the Sister Soldier thing was to push back on that. Well, I'm a black president, but I'm not one that's actually going to help black people.
No, that was before. That was when he was running. And that was very specifically calibrated to use Jesse Jackson as a stand-in to humiliate the black community. That
well,
was
that's
part
what I'm saying.
Of,
but,
no,
but,
I'm
but,
saying even, but it, that was even before that phrase was coined. That phrase was, I think, actually coined in the White House. This was when he
was
running
right?
for president. I think so.
Well, that was also triangulation, and that was also Dick Moore. But no, Dick Morris, I don't think he was in the administration then. But
he
I'm
was
just
in
saying, 96. Like, when the mainstream, when people was, and they still even do that today, they say it's good politics. That Trump wanted to ban the Muslims. There's still that talk today. Where, I mean, do you think if Trump had talked about Jews, had said Jews like instead of the birthers, do you think he would have gotten the Republican nomination? I mean, we're just such a racist country. No one cared that he would. I mean, we care, but people don't care that he's a birther because they don't think they don't get that there's racism. Where they're good with racism. Hey, I'm getting more depressed than you
guys.
Those
politics haven't really gone away either. Like, Joe Biden is close to the front runner for the Democratic nomination, and he's doing the same thing. Like, he's talking like populist talk, but his policies are like, we want to make it better for the credit card companies and put more black people in jail. Like, it's bullshit.
He's not saying that directly. Come on now, that's going too far. So if he implies things, I'm sorry.
Can you
guys.
Imagine
I'm so,
Joe Biden
I'm so sarcastic
with a Republican with a Republican Senate? I mean, you want to talk about disaster?
Hey.
Goodbye, Social Security, and that I was able to get increased funding on Amtrak. On Amtrak, yeah. Forgive me, Father. And so I cut some Social Security.
Forgive me, Father. I phased out Medicare because I got an extra $600 million for an Amtrak lane from Delaware to D.C.
Like
the purity of it all.
It's like he's been frozen in amber since 1992.
Well, yes, but maybe it's not.
That was
amber.
What
maybe
I said
like
on my wedding night.
Botox
I'm
injections.
They do tend to preserve
in amber
you.
So it was Toni Morrison who called Bill Clinton the first black president, and she
who
98 Toni Morrison
and the
New
lots
Yorker
of other people have said that since
but that was when it was coined. So it was coined after the fact, but the idea was that that Clinton was born of. Had every, supposedly like trope of blackness, single parent, single parent household, poor.
She was coding, the class right. race. Actually, I mean, it was a much more, it became a funny line and a joke, but it was actually a serious point. And that was actually, Barack Obama got that question. They asked it sort of as a joke in a debate, but they literally asked him, what do you think about like Bill's title as the first right. black president. That was like an actual CNN debate question. Barack Obama's like,
yeah.
double.
Well, Andy,
and yet,
I think we're out of time.
Oh, you can't go 2 hours over with me? Oh, I'm the bad guy because I'm long-winded? Oh.
What are you? Where are you touring? First off, obviously, people should be listening.
Should see me.
Should see.
I have a really great podcast. I call it great. I have a podcast.
I was just
with J. Elvis Weinstein. There's no guests. It's two Jews
just
who talk
spiraling
and wine
out
for
of
2 hours.
Spiraling out of like their thought becomes spiraling.
That's it. You got it. You, my friend, got it. Yeah, I have that. Also,
what is the name? What is the name of the
Calgary?
What is the name of
Calgary at the end of June?
What is the name of the podcast?
Thought Spiral.
Oh my God!
You heard it?
My Jewish friends tell me that they like to lend other people money, which helps them pay for their synagogues. So that's a Shylock. So I'm told.
Two welfare queens. They walk into a bar. I can't do Reagan. That's why I couldn't do Nixon. I couldn't do Reagan.
That's why you didn't get the Andy Kaufman film, I'm told.
That's why we all need to vote for Bernie Sanders, right?
So where else are you going to be?
That's right.
Where else?
Hey, that's the kind of thing that makes you go, I wonder if Arsenio is still working. Okay, I'm sorry.
Where else can
I'm going to be in Calgary at the end of June and then at various spots in L.A.
Oh, all right. Well, fine.
Oh, you guys are mean. I mean, you
no,
guys are.
I want to
I mean,
see
you
can
tell
on the
that it
East
sounds
Coast.
Bad.
Any Bob's Burgers as of late?
I don't want to say this is kind of sad that this changed my life.
I got
a large check.
I got that same one. I was talking to Benjamin
about
that.
I love you, Sam. Let's buy. I don't know if we should buy cocaine. I want to buy something and die or cocaine
that
or something.
Came
so I'm
out
so happy
of,
about
they,
it.
Everybody got that except for the one that everybody who works on the show regulars, their check was much bigger than ours. I can assure you.
Well, any chance that you give me to have a little bit more bitterness, walking around bitterness money.
Yours could be bigger than mine, but yes, there was some big buyout
Show
or something.
Me
but
the
have
money.
You done it lately or no?
I did one episode like a month ago.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I'm very happy.
Apparently, I've been written out of the show. I wouldn't worry about it.
Well, you know, I have been bad mouthing you, which I do feel bad about. I say, Sam still show up drunk for the voiceovers.
Why not?
No, it's fine.
Nobody sees
it's
me.
Fine.
It helps my performance. Why wouldn't I?
Well, he goes on MSNBC. I certainly hope he's committed to doing the cartoon voices now. He's very much of a radical. I don't know if you've heard him. I don't know if you want him associated with the show. I could do his part.
And
what's your part again, Sam? You're the fireman. You're the guy. You're the health inspector,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, the health inspector. That's right. Not the fireman.
Give me a couple of seconds, and I'll try it.
Wait, what's the character you play, Mort?
Yeah, Mort. Hey, I'm next door. I'm at the mortuary. Hey, Bob. That's mine. Now you go ahead. See if you can top that.
Hello, Bob. It's me, Hugo, the health inspector.
I didn't say. Don't do Don Adams. Are you doing Don Adams?
A little bit.
Unbelievable.
This is so
delightful. I love you guys. I'm sorry I sucked up so much time, and I'm sorry I interrupted occasionally. I'm sorry that half the things I think are going to be funny bomb,
right.
And I'm sorry for Netanyahu.
Well, let me... Well, I'm happy for all of it except for the Netanyahu part. You
Andy
probably should have
Kindler
thought about that a little bit
tries
more.
Tries to be funny.
Andy, as always...
Very disappointed in Netanyahu's direction.
Andy...
Andy,
I love
always
Mort.
A pleasure.
I really do. I must say,
oh,
as someone who
you.
Watches Bob's Burgers, he's the best.
Thank you, guys.
Well, the second
I love
best.
You guys so much, even though you made me want to jump off a building before I got on.
Oh, Andy, what are you doing?
Because you got me, you and the last guest were like, it made me sad that you were saying the country's not doing so well.
The second best.
Our country's dying.
All right, Andy. Thank you. Gotta go.
Hey, what are you? We're going through your mail now, Sam? What the hell's wrong with you?
Appreciate the call.
Okay,
gotta
Andy.
Go. Gotta
I'm
go.
Not, this isn't a phone call that we're having in the 90s. I'm a guest.
I gotta go. I got mail. Bye.
I love you. Bye-bye.
I love you.
The lost art phone conversation.
I know it. No, I just was trying to launch the fans thing, and Kyle changed something, and he didn't tell me, and now I don't know how to do it.
Do kids even talk on the phone anymore? I spent so much time on the phone with my friends when I was a kid.
Mila does not. I don't think so. All right, we're going to take a quick break. Be right back. Oh, yeah, we got a song from who is it from?
Adam Rainstopper.
Adam Rainstopper.
And plugs.
Yeah, we have to do plugs too.
Oh, yeah.
Battle Hymn of the Ideas is what this is called. Should we do plugs first?
Yes.
Battle Hymn of the Idea.
I have to say, my brain is still in recovery mode from taking on so many important high-level ideas.
Folks, just a reminder, this show relies on you for its support. You can become a member by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. When you do, we give you extra time every day, and we also give it to you commercial free. As always, we will not turn anybody away for financial reasons, however. So if you want access to the fun half of the show, people, we get emails all the time, which I want to say I appreciate folks who find the show, you know, helpful. A lot of folks who are taking care of maybe of family members or are going through some illness themselves or out of work and are looking for work. Find the show to be good entertainment for them and keep them informed. And so if you are one of those folks who can't get in, send us an email at majorityreporters@gmail.com and we'll set you up. All right, got to take today's Friday, Tuesday. Go.
Yeah, chair. Michael Brooks Show, check it out. Get the whole thing at patreon.com/TMBS or get a good dose of it and then become a patron by going to the Michael Brooks Show on YouTube.
Jamie.
This week on the Antifada, it's not as good as it is when I'm there, but it's still pretty good. Sean talked to some leftist media folks from Means TV, The Serfs, who we recently helped get their channel reinstated to YouTube, and Non-Compete about leftist media and related topics. We also have a brand new show called Prolet Cult, hosted by producer AP Andy, where he talks about UFOs, the paranormal, the parapolitical, and the parasocial from a Marxist perspective. So check it out. Also, oh yes, we are having a fundraiser party for North Brooklyn DSA tomorrow in Brooklyn, kind of Queens, Brooklyn, I don't know, Bushwick, Ridgewood, at TransPicos. If you want to support all of the work that we're doing in North Brooklyn DSA, you can buy a ticket whether or not you're coming. So I put that link underneath the YouTube.
I got my ticket. I don't know if I'm going to be able to come. I might be able to, but I got the kids this weekend, but I got my ticket. So
well, thank you.
Check it out, folks. Matt.
A Literary Hangover. Check it out on YouTube. Subscribe to it.
That's it?
Oh, Matt wins the brevity contest.
Excuse us. All right. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back with the fun half. 646-257-3920.
Say that my brain is still in recovery mode from taking in so many high-level important ideas.
I operate exactly as I was in-
We are back. Sam Seder on the Majority Report. Give me a second. I'm trying to do the phone login here, and it's just not working. Here, play a song. Michael, talk.
I'm still in recovery mode from taking on so many important high-level ideas.
Ooh, this is getting sexy.
Literally cannot process that, how funny that drop is.
I feel I have to get the gushing out first.
That was when he met Thomas Soul.
Oh, that's
who
gross.
Was the first who was
See, I talked to black guys.
I talked to black guys. Black guys who don't like black guys.
Just the other day I had Thomas Soul.
I had Thomas Soul. And I had to get the gushing out of the way first.
Oh my God!
Brazilian Prime Minister,
I think
Bolsonaro regarding
what is it?
Deforestation of Iranian forests. P.S. I'm a Christian. I bake you a cake, though. You know, I don't know enough about him.
Do we know what the state of really hates Marxism
is? By the way, it's a fucking disaster. All right, we can't. We're not going to do calls today. I'm sorry, folks. Everything's all messed up. Can't do calls today.
You could still do IMs, right?
Still do IMs, and
it's just annoying.
Kyle, goddamn it! Hello.
And what's going on now with the IMs?
That I could not speak to. Can't speak to either of these.
So annoying.
Did someone sabotage them because he wants to go home early?
The Russians. Did you hear our Brendan bit yesterday, Sam?
No,
that was good.
It was embedded in the ZipRecruiter ad for members, but it's David Copperfield, Brendan.
Yeah, turns out that Brendan sleeps on a pallet of hay underneath your stairs, Sam. Did you know that?
That was how we found him.
Yeah, he was a little Irish boy who came. He said, sir, I could do clipping for you if you give John me a Stewart, plate of milk and some potatoes.
John Stewart left him in the cradle.
And Sam had to rescue him.
Disco
Stew. My real
father
was a much more successful Jewish comedian, but he abandoned me.
Disco Stew. Glenn Greenwald on Tucker last night, agreeing with Tucker that the DOJ needs to be focused on the spying on the Trump campaign since the whole Russia investigation was a hoax. I mean, seriously, come on. Glenn lied to your face on this program during your debate. He goes on Fox News Klan programming to critique the media, boosting Michael Tracy to bash Marcy Wheeler. He's Jimmy Dore. I mean, look, I can't explain why he's doing that. It is quite clear why the DOJ investigated Trump. They got reports from the ambassador, from an Australian ambassador that George Papadopoulos, who was getting information from a professor who has essentially disappeared at this point, that the Russians had information that they were going to leak. And the Papadopoulos told an ambassador, an Australian envoy, and they started an investigation, an intelligence investigation based on that. And the idea that they were, you know, they did spy on Papadopoulos. They didn't have, they didn't put listening devices in Trump Tower. Maybe they would have known what that thing was about. I can't explain it. It is completely bizarre to me, frankly, why he's doing that. Why he would go on. It's completely bizarre to me. But that's what it is. On this program, he said that there was evidence, and in fact, there was evidence of collusion. There was evidence of the case. There was not enough, and this is specifically laid out in the Mueller investigation, not enough to bring charges. And he reiterated that on this program with me. And he did not say that on Tucker last night. He said there was no evidence. That is also not true. The Mueller investigation did not say this whole thing was a hoax. What is a hoax? There's a definition of it. We have words. Words mean things. Hoax, a humorous or malicious deception. Deceive with a hoax. What is the deception here? There was an investigation. The Mueller investigation was not a hoax. It was an investigation. Were there members of the Democratic Party? Were there pundits who tried to deceive? That's a separate question. I don't know the answer to that. But the Mueller investigation was not a hoax. It was warranted, and it found a lot of it found a lot of things. It did not prove the central tenet, although that was, you know, we've mentioned pretty narrowly constructed. But and Bonara. Been absolutely loving Michael's Juan Guaido, waiting for more people to sign on to Periscope. Steve Seder, when is Matt going to give the people what they want and start a Spotify playlist of all the music he plays during intermissions? By the way, I already bought it's already there, folks.
Yeah, that exists. It's called Majority Report Official and Often Updated.
Hello.
And there's already 443 people following it.
That's right. I am one of them. I am one of them.
Sometimes I need to do the drop when it isn't there. It's a very appropriate drop. Prager. Mocking Dave to his face.
You know who else was on Tucker last night was Stephen Moore. And this will be the last that we hear from Stephen Moore for a while. So let's play it. Here is Stephen Moore wondering why on the one true journalist, apparently, that is Tucker Carlson's show, Stephen Moore is on there wondering why he is now being maligned by people who hired him. And really the question is, really should be, why did those people hire him in the first place?
Truth to that, because, you know, but I will say this, you know who was the biggest fight, the guy who did not want me to withdraw from this?
Who?
Donald J.
Good.
Trump.
Well, I believe that.
That's what I love about him. He's a fighter. And I just, at the end, I just had to say, I don't know if I can
pause it. Now, who believes that? Stephen Moore was telling reporters 30 minutes before Donald Trump announced that he was dropped, that Stephen Moore was dropping out, withdrawing. that it's full steam ahead. What happened in those 29 minutes to change Stephen Moore? They had to go and argue with the president. No, no, no. I'm dropping out. I know you want me in here. There's Stephen Moore lying, almost like trying to pull what would be a deception or a hoax on us on Tucker Carlson's show. But continue.
I don't know if I can believe
it. So really quick,
I believe it.
I thought you just resigned at CNN. They wanted you to work there, and then I'm watching tonight, and they're telling me that like you're evil.
How did this is a little awkward for CNN because every night they trash me now. When for the last 2.5 years I've been their senior economics writer, and the things that they're talking about now are things that happened 20 years ago. Wait a minute, if I'm such a scoundrel and sexist, why did they have me on every night?
Good cue.
What's the answer?
Well, I mean, I don't know. You'd have to ask them. But the point is, you know, I don't think you should hold accountable, you know, for things that were written 25 years ago. They even looked at my Christmas letters that we would send.
Pause it. We have played multiple clips today. Him making racist jokes or just not saying how much he loved the racist joke. Talking about women being in the kitchen as recently as 2617, as recently as 2014. That's not 20 years ago. I'm not great with math, but I know that's like within. So what's the cutoff? Is that okay? Or is it should be like, you shouldn't go back more than 20 weeks ago for the record.
Letters that we would send out to friends and family that were just kind of jokes. We'd make fun of everyone.
Yeah.
And
you've got to stand up to these people. I mean, it's disgusting what's happening. It's disgusting what happened to you and Kavanaugh and a lot of other people in this city. Anyway. Stephen Moore, you're always welcome on the show. Thank you for
coming.
Thank
you, Tucker.
Yeah, great.
Here's a hot take. Stephen Moore and CNN are both bad.
Yeah, that's a very good question. Stephen Moore is right to point out that CNN should have never hired Stephen Moore.
Maybe they should look if there's any other people they shouldn't have hired that they are currently hiring.
Right, but yeah.
We don't have to pick. Both of those things can be true.
Exactly. It's just shocking to me because Tucker is the bastion of journalistic integrity, and I'm surprised that he let Stephen Moore come on there and tell a blatant lie about the fact that Donald Trump was the one guy who wanted him on there, and Stephen Moore had to fight him.
I mean, Tucker
Steve,
likes to
don't go.
Tucker likes to make it out like it's all about Bub and the Love Sponge, but as the Michael Tracy thing showed, people give him a pass on the Iraq stuff too.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, he gets a big pass on that. Speaking of giving people a pass, here's another thing that's wrong with Joe Biden. I mean, look, forgive me, Father. So I campaigned for a republic. Forgive me, Father. Here he is.
I gotta admit, I kind of like that move. That's so, that is very BDE.
It's, yeah.
It's just, whatever. Screw you. It is, that's probably why.
This is Joe Biden. And Walter Mondale at the University of Minnesota back in, 2015?
Yep.
While he's sitting vice president. And two vice presidents. Mondale was, wasn't he, was, I don't even believe Mondale was, in fact.
Mondale was Carter's
vice president. I'm probably the only person I know who read Walter Mondale's biography.
Back in fascinating.
The fascinating.
And then Walter went to the Bureau of Labor Statistics and he got a manual.
Exactly.
And he looked it up, and that was how they developed a new method.
So
for
two
cola
vice
payments.
Presidents, one sitting, one not. And they're there, and they're talking about Dick Cheney.
Vice President Biden, did you talk to your immediate predecessor about this?
I did. No, I didn't talk to him about the job. Look,
no, but about how the vice presidency worked?
No, what I talked to him about him, look, first of all, I actually like Dick Cheney for real. I get on with him. I think he's a decent man. When I went to see him.
Pause it for 1 second. Let's just take a moment and talk about what constitutes decency in a man or woman, for that matter. What is it? What does it take for you not to be a decent person? Okay, so let's just say we have a baseline. Cares about his wife. Cares about his children. Maybe even donates money to a charity or two or five in the community. What is the base? Is it impossible for you not to be a decent man at that point? What if you, when you drive by certain neighborhoods, you give the finger to kids playing on the streets that you don't like. I mean, does that make you undecent even if you do all those other things? Or what if actually you see a cat or a dog in the street and you decide, like, I'm going to speed up just a little bit to hit it because I just want to see how that feels, or that's fun, or whatever. Does that make you undecent if you do all those other things? Or what if you encourage the invasion of a country that leads to the deaths of hundreds of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of innocent people? And you also force intelligence agencies so that to give you information so that you can basically present a lie to an entire country to allow for the killing of hundreds of thousands of people, mothers, daughters, sons, fathers, killing all of them and creating 4 million refugees. But you're good to your wife. You're good to your kids. Give to a bunch of charities in your community, and you're also, you know, if you say you're going to be at lunch with somebody, you show up there at time. Does that make you a decent man? I'm just curious, where's the bar? What can you do to not be a decent man if Dick Cheney is a decent man?
Don't forget the part where you have to be nice to Joe Biden.
Right.
No, I am, you know, more on the side of, like, let's all deal with the fact that nobody's perfect and so on. And part of the reason that I have that perspective is I think you do need to actually hold the true, this is a genuinely evil negative force in the world for those occasions where it really rises up. And I think Dick Cheney would be the most clear example of that, maybe even still in the Trump era, from Halliburton to torture to voting against a resolution to free Nelson Mandela.
Yeah.
To, by the way, this is should be an angle not just you know, for the left issues we're talking about, but Biden's riding Obama's coattails. Dick Cheney was at the forefront of profound disrespect, borderline incitement against Barack Obama.
Yeah, I'm just curious as a philosophical question. What does it take in Joe Biden's mind to be an undecent man?
Yeah.
Continue.
Signing
like Dick Cheney,
a fake.
For real. I get on with him. I think he's a decent man. When I went to see him, I didn't talk to him before. I went to see him after we were elected. And I went to see him at the residence, and he and his wife were extremely gracious to Jill and to me.
Wow.
And he talked about how the office worked as related to the functioning of the office.
This is how you stovepipe intelligence.
But he had a very different relationship, and he was a powerful vice president. He had a very different relationship with President Bush. And one of the things I learned from, and it probably sounds like I'm making this up when I say I learned from, but I spoke to this man repeatedly about this job.
And doesn't Mondale, don't we keep going here? Mondale says something like, yeah, let's get that clip because we owe it to Walter Mondale to show that there's actually, I mean, because this is important actually, because it is not a requisite for you as a politician to simply judge other politicians based upon not what they do as a politician, but as like the way that they are in their real life. Like, I want people to have a glimpse of Dick Cheney. Like, we all have this caricature of Dick Cheney and this and that, but I want you to know in real life, he was really gracious to me as the sitting vice president. Like, and that takes a lot out of a guy. You know,
yeah.
A lot of people, that's one of the things, I have on my Bumble profile is like, I want to make sure that you treat waiters and waitresses and sitting vice presidents nicely, because that's the way you measure the decency of a human being.
I recall Cheney gave an interview right before Obama was inaugurated, actually, and this was not just even to Biden. This was a big interview, and he talked about the legacy of Bobby Kennedy and MLK, and said it was a great day for America. So yeah. It's like, okay,
He's capable of saying. Do we have the rest of that clip?
First of all, I act.
Okay.
We've got it.
He's always been really nice to me.
I'm fine. What a wonderful, wonderful man.
Yeah. Vice President Biden, did you talk to your immediate predecessor about this?
I did. No, I didn't.
Okay.
But he had a very different relationship, and he was a powerful vice president. He had a very different relationship with President Bush. And one of the things I learned from, and it probably sounds like I'm making this up when I say I learned from, but I spoke to this man repeatedly about this job. And
I think that Joe Biden could say, like, I learned from this guy. I didn't agree with him, and I had some real problems with what he did, but there's not many vice presidents, and I learned some things from him as much as I was not, you know, what you would call a fan. He could have said that. And in fact, even if he thought in his heart, nice guy, very nice to me, on some level, the idea that he doesn't think that he has a responsibility to show some measure of, maybe disdain's too strong of a word, but to show some measure of dissent as to anybody who's creating a narrative that this is how a vice president should act. Like, you have a responsibility to the country, to society, even if you don't even feel that personally, to indicate some problem with this man because of what he did. In fact, the reason why you're sitting there as a sitting vice president is because Barack Obama was supposedly against that war. And why would you be against that war? Because there was no reason to wage it, and it killed hundreds of thousands of people. Dick Cheney was intimately involved in both of those aspects.
It's an insult to people's intelligence, too. We're not here to find out. Nobody in that audience is there to find out about Dick Cheney as a private person.
Well, that's the thing. He's saying, like, it's almost more important.
Yeah, to what degree is this a game to you if you think being friends with other people in the political class is more important than the lives of hundreds of thousands of human beings?
The aircraft to the housing, et cetera.
Vice President Mondale, do you have some views on the Cheney vice presidency?
A little bit different, I would say. he was kind to me. He's kind to Joan. We visited the home and so on. But he said early on that he was going to take things to the dark side. And I believe he really did. And he created the vice presidency as sort of a privileged sanctuary. Wouldn't respond to subpoenas, stiff the Congress on who his.
He had a different view.
Yeah, and he worked with some of his key guys to bring about the torture memo and so on. I think those were bad days in the history of the vice president. I know all the things you said are right, but I have a kind of a.
I don't disagree with that.
Harsh view of the man.
I have a harsh view of how the vice presidency, the office, was used. And so that's why
passive,
I never...
Passive, right. It was unfortunate what happened to... it was unfortunate what happened to Anita Hill. All these things happen. And people just happen to be there. You know, I have to say this, honestly. Like, I never paid that much attention to Joe Biden. I mean, years ago as a senator, you know, I was not terribly enamored with him. The Democratic Party was to the right of where it is. And, you know, I was never a fan. But the more I watch Joe Biden now, like, honestly, like, I don't know if there's anybody in the Democratic race. Like I say, in the first, I don't know, top eight candidates. I don't know who, you know, after that. But Joe Biden, I think, is just a horribly problematic person. I mean, as a leader, and I mean, politics, but just like, just even this exchange where he's like, oh, yeah, no, I can, if you're going to remind everybody about the torture, about the disdain for Congress, about the war, about all these things, let me just say, it's unfortunate that that stuff happened around him. But if there was anybody in the Bush administration responsible for the horrific things that happened during the Bush administration, if you could point to one person, I don't think you can ever point to one person, but if you had to, you would have to say Dick Cheney. And now I get, he said this back in 2015, it's before the movie Vice came out. But seriously, this is bad stuff. And, you know, I talked to Weigel on Monday about, you know, sort of what the Democratic voters that he's come in contact with are trying to think. But there's going to be a tremendous amount of buyer's remorse if people think, A, that it doesn't matter who can beat Donald Trump, and B, that Joe Biden necessarily can. I mean, I you know, like, let me put it this way. Shows like ours tend to be canaries in the coal mine. And now this stuff may not be effective for Donald Trump to put out there on video, but people are going to. It exists. And this is highly problematic, I think.
Well, I think there are arguments for both Biden and Bernie being able to beat Trump. I think Biden will peel off the people who care more about being socially conservative, and Bernie will peel the people off who care more about economic populism and their material interests. But given that there are equally strong arguments for both electability, we need to pick the one that is going to be good, that's going to help people and not, you know, bring back all the terrible politics from the 90s.
It's pretty bad. But here's,
as I said yesterday, just support Sanders. But if you must support a center-right candidate, support Harris. This is my editorial now.
Making deals.
Speaking of things that are going to make you feel a little better, here is Elizabeth Warren. I should say there's just a tweet about it. We don't have fully yet, but she's announcing a Territorial Relief Act policy. Interesting, you know, in the wake of our story about territories and whatnot. But it will provide Puerto Rico with a path to comprehensive debt relief. I mean, and she's been on this for, I guess, since 2016 or so, maybe 2015, with the vulture capitalists who have gone down there and basically leveraged all this property down there. It's pretty stunning. But good for her. Let's play the, this is also fun. Hey, you remember this guy, Tommy Robinson? He's come up occasionally, in the context of this program. This is a guy who is, a right-wing nationalist, would you say?
He's been affiliated with UKIP and I think also BNP, British National Party, which has a direct brown shirt, black shirt history.
Yeah, and he's primarily anti-Muslim activist. Yeah,
primarily anti-Muslim guy. He's also somebody who left Dave in recovery mode from taking on so many important high-level
ideas. Yeah, he features in the Timbon Toast video.
And he is so so adept that he, for an entire hour, spoke to Dave Rubin, of all people. And if you can get through the gauntlet of talking to Dave Rubin...
Without hanging yourself,
oh my gosh. Enough so that Sam Harris was convinced, pretty good guy.
Everything he said seemed reasonable.
But apparently, this kid, I think we need to name Don Yal, maybe. This is in Warrington, Cheshire. I don't know if his name is Don Yal, but he was campaigning there, and guy came up to talk to Tommy Robinson, and whoops, milkshake.
Jumping around like he was going to do something. Didn't do shit. The only person you pushed was a woman. No, you was, but We'll show you the footage later. So you come here very aggressively. You go over. Tommy, don't go.
That's what you get for being a fascist.
Fuck off.
You fucking Nazi prick.
Yeah, bitch.
Did a guy say, Tommy, it's not worth it? Yeah, did he say that?
Yeah, Tommy, it's not worth it.
Oh, my God. Every time you throw food on a fascist, an angel gets its wings.
Milkshake beautiful. Is pretty
that
good.
That was so great. He's like, you're not going to do nothing. You're not going to do...
Oh! He was quoted as saying, like, a milkshake won't stop this campaign, something which is a very funny thing to have to put in a newspaper.
Yeah. Gotta appreciate that.
Apparently,
that's the second time he's gotten milkshake.
Yeah, I couldn't find the second one. The earlier one, I think this was the second time. But it's milkshakes or eggs, I think. Either are interesting tactics. So diversity of tactics we need.
That's right.
Indeed.
Food products.
Keep it simple.
This is also fascinating. Steny Hoyer is getting a challenge.
I support her.
Yeah. So that's the end of the segment. Steny Hoyer, exactly. Second most powerful Democrat in the House. Often at odds with Nancy Pelosi on some issues, which, you know, tells you something. This is a guy, if you thought Joe Biden represented credit card interests and corporate interest, let me introduce you to Steny Hoyer. And he is in Maryland's 5th congressional district. And, you know, one of the things that I think Digby made the point, it is the case. There is a big deficit of leadership in the Democratic Party, it seems to me, amongst my generation in particular. Steny Hoyer is almost 80. And... look, I'm all in favor of 80-year-olds, 70-year-olds, and this and that. I tend to, you know, many of them are stuck in politics in the past. But it's quite clear that the future of the party lies in people who are in their 20s and, you know, their 30s to a certain extent. But for some reason, there's a huge deficit of people in their 40s and 50s. I have theories about that. But nevertheless, people in their 20s seems to be the only ones who feel like who actually, you know, it's almost like they actually have that audacity of hope. Like they took it seriously.
Right. Right.
And
a lot of people who took Obama's words seriously and didn't like his policies.
Well, I think. And they could have gone one of two directions. They could have gotten completely cynical about it, or they could have said, like, we're going to take the rhetoric and actually put it into action. Here's a woman, Michaela Wilkes. And I don't know much about her, I got to tell you, but this is a pretty brave way to start your campaign. And I guess maybe from her perspective, it was the only way, but she's not going to let that stop her. Listen to this ad.
I didn't think that I would be where I am today. Chances are that I should be unemployed in jail or probably even worse. I'm running for Congress for Maryland's 5th District, but getting here has definitely not been easy. When I was 15, I was placed in juvenile detention facilities for running away from home. There was even one instance where a guard threatened to hold me down and cut my braids out if I didn't cut them out myself. I was even jailed for driving on a suspended license. I was 7 months pregnant, living paycheck to paycheck. I couldn't afford to pay all my tickets and court fees, and I had no choice but to drive or I'd lose my job. We need a criminal justice system that offers rehabilitation instead of exploitation. This is why I want to end cash bail. I want to end the failed war on drugs, and I want to make sure that pregnant women are treated fairly in prison. And I also want to get rid of the predatory rates that prisoners and their families are forced to pay in order to speak to their loved ones. Families shouldn't have to choose between putting food on the table and making a phone call to talk to one of their loved ones. Our representation is so out of touch with the people's needs. Even worse, they're funded by those who profit off our most vulnerable. Check out the rest of my platform online because we've got a lot of work to do. I'm Michaela Wilkes, and I'm running as who I am for who we are.
That is a brilliant ad.
Good for her.
That is so clean. So direct,
yep.
So on point, so honest. I mean, I got to learn more, but that's amazing.
Yeah, that's pretty impressive stuff. Steny Hoyer couldn't be a better person to primary, frankly.
He sits in front of the camera. He's like, I've been working closely with AGRA and oil and energy lobbyists for decades.
I'm glad you said about ending cash bail because I wanted to make it possible also to use your credit card.
Apple Pay.
Yeah.
Why is there any reason we can't use Venmo to take money out of people's accounts?
We're working with Jack Dorsey. He's got a new proposal here.
Part of the problem is that we only allow 30% interest rates on bail. So what I want to do is jack that up to 65%.
I'm going to introduce a segment program called Positive Tweets About Moderate Democrats for Bail.
Man, Steny Hoyer is such trash.
Unbelievable. Lastly, this is pretty fascinating, particularly for Matt, who lives in these parts. This is a big deal. The Ogallala Sioux tribe, which is a tribe that is in the, I guess, the lives in South Dakota.
Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota.
And this is about, I don't know, 5% of the territory of South Dakota, maybe. It's pretty big. And South Dakota turns out to be pretty big. Can't believe that.
It's about, this reservation itself is about a 1/20th to a 25th of the state of South Dakota.
Yeah, that would be 5%.
They said, oh yeah, gotcha.
And
I heard a fifth, but you might
four to right. 4 to 5%. And they have basically sent a letter to South Dakota Governor Kristi Noem. This is from the president, Julian Bear Runner, president of the Ogallala Sioux tribe. I'm hereby notifying you that you are not welcome to visit our homelands, the Pine Ridge Reservation, until you rescind your support for SB 1189 and SB, 189 and SB 190, and affirm to your state in this country that the First Amendment rights to free political speech are among the truths that you hold to be self-evident. Your newly fabricated, unconstitutionally vague notion of riot boosting is being litigated against and will not stand. We are particularly offended that you consulted TransCanada before introducing these bills, but failed to consult the Ogallala Sioux tribe or any of the sovereign bands of Sioux Nation, though our treaty lands would be traversed and endangered by the Keystone XL pipeline. This, of course, is part of the DAPL, South Dakota Access Pipeline.
Is that the bill that would make it legal to run over protesters with your car?
That's a North Dakota bill, actually.
Yeah,
they want to do what's going on apparently in Venezuela.
Right.
Yeah, basically,
it's a travesty when it's in Venezuela. Here, it's actually forward-looking policy.
Right, there you go. We will be invading South Dakota shortly to stop this, apparently. We have superior title to all the land west of the Missouri River, and you and or big oil seek to trespass and aggress on. These are our lands and our waters. Before you presume to visit our homelands again, the Sioux Tribe Council must rescind its action as of May 1st, 2019. If you do not honor this directive, for example, if you were to repeat your recent visit absent permission from our tribal government, we'll have no choice but to banish you.
Nice. Solidarity. And the rest of the Sioux tribes, if you follow suit, we will support you as well.
Let's go to the IMs. Go take a couple of these IMs and get going. We don't have calls today, folks. I'm sorry about that. Brave-O-Matic, how about faxes? Are you accepting faxes? Trumpy style. It might seem remarkable that Jason Chaffetz towed the line on supporting Trump, especially after saying he couldn't look his daughter in the eye after if he voted for him. But one can easily imagine Trump explaining to Chaffetz that he's doing it wrong anyway if he can look his daughter in the eye. No bumps in the road. Jamie, have you ever read Inventing the Future, the Post-Capitalism, the World Without Work from 2015? It has some arguments there that challenge my anarcho-communism. You might find it interesting.
I will check it out.
I can't find it anyways. Matt, physical indication. nods knowingly when Sam introduces guest Heather Digby and responds to Sam's pleasant surprise with a big hang 10, brother. Calling from Nebraska. Happy Friday, MR crew. Sam sent you an email titled Nebraska Senator Ernie Chambers. It's about 30 minutes of content, and Michael, the 1.5 minute video in the email will be great TMBS opening video. Have a great weekend. I'll be seeing Beto for a town hall at a middle school tomorrow. LOL. Contagious chameleon. Conservatives are getting absolutely crushed in British local elections. Well, that's good. Worcester polygot. I don't know what that symbol means. Greater than, more or less, greater than, more or less. Just because. Sam, two things. Herman Cade said the main reason he dropped out was that he would have to give up his speech-giving grifting. He never mentioned that he also didn't have the votes in the Senate. On a more serious note, the Alabama House passed a bill to put a doctor in prison for up to 99 years for performing an abortion. Yep. I love Sarah Palin. Hey, Sam, I've been listening. I mentioned that at the top of the show, at the top of the interview yesterday with, was it yesterday? 2 days ago. Robin Marty. Hey, Sam, I've been listening to people complain about this new Biden poll and Bernie's thoughts on prisoners voting all week, and it's tiring. If voters want someone whose policies they can support during the primary and someone that can beat Trump in the general, I've got the perfect candidate. Don't get triggered, but it's Hillary Rodham Clinton. Listen, if the left wants to say in the direction of the country, we need someone that can win elections and unify the left, so why not pick someone who's already won a Democratic primary and won the general, too? It might be slightly superfluous, but have you seen her and them in pantsuits?
Is this a joke?
I don't know. Gregory from Oklahoma.
Yes, it is.
When I was in fourth grade, I used to wake up early in the morning and watch reruns of the show Home Movies. Little did I know until last year that Sam had did the voice of one of the characters on the show. Sam, you've been keeping me entertained for over 10 years. Thank you for what you're doing. Bren! That's Fenton Mueller.
I never watched the show.
Yeah, all right.
Sorry.
Bill Pilgrim. The New York State deadline to write. We guys are supposed to remind me.
I did it yesterday.
Oh, we did it yesterday.
But we forgot. Sorry.
New York State deadline to register the vote in the primary that you guys have been mentioning applies to a primary scheduled for next month, June 25th, not the 2020 presidential primary.
Oh, well, do it anyway.
No use waiting.
Seriously, especially in New York, it's not that because it's a little bit of a process. They're not really
that
great.
Yeah, they will purge your ass from the rolls for no reason.
You might, Matt told the story, like, you know, you got to double check, make sure you're actually registered. They don't have a great process here. This isn't like a Washington State as an example.
Yeah, Nomiki Konst couldn't vote for herself because she had been removed from the rolls somehow.
Eesh. I just became a member last night. Can I get a shofar? Yes, you can, Gleason. Thank you. The support. Appreciate it. Cap no fun. Can I get a shofar? I got a big fat raise yesterday. As of this morning, I'm stoked to say I'm finally a member. Love it what you do. Oh, wow. All right.
Hell yeah.
Hope that's not the same person. Frankie B. Hey, Sam. Big ruling today out of the state of Ohio. Ohio Supreme Court ruled the new congressional map can be drawn due to the current maps favoring Republicans. Fingers crossed that this trend continues. This also went down to Michigan. It remains to be seen. There are two cases in front of the Supreme Court that are going to be resolved. We're going to know within 6 weeks. And it's going to be interesting to see what the implications of these cases are relative to that. But that's good news. Swedartha, Greenwald cares more about getting attention than the truth. The dude is a hack. I mean, I really don't understand what, I don't think it's about attention, but I don't know what it's about,
no,
but it doesn't
Russia,
make sense.
The Russia story broke people's brains on both sides of it.
I think that's true. I think some of those people's on both sides were brains were already pretty broken. And then it just, you know. Right about now, too, have you heard about the occupation and hunger strike of poor families in El Paso who's been fighting school closings for 3 years? Today is day 5 of the hunger strike. I have not heard about that. Send a link if you have one at majorityreporters@gmail.com. We'll talk about it on Monday. Rob Cully, listening to Rogan only because Anthony Jeselnik it was on. We all know Joe is very bright and he doesn't know how algorithms work. He starts how he watches a YouTube video about bulletproof hoodies, then gets a video about a guy with a bullet in the chamber, and then he goes on to Twitter and his timeline's all about people getting shot. It's like, dude, this stuff is going on everywhere. What an effing bird brain. Have a great weekend. Not sure I follow any of that. Wisconsinite. Hello, is this me? IMs are capable of providing the phone experience. PDX Tony, can you guys speculate why Warren has these weird nuance issues with Medicare for All? Her other policy positions are so left progressive, but in the most important electoral issue at all, she equivocates. Also, Matt, are the Portland tri- I don't know. I got to dig into that. The only thing I could say is that it's maybe just a way of distinguishing herself. Maybe there's only so many enemies that she feels that she can make in terms of big. I don't know.
And it could just be that she's a technocratic liberal and she thinks that these are all different versions of the same thing when they're not.
A local pizza historian, update for you guys on Wednesday's state of the company thing. I cowered out from asking if any of the double-digit percentages of revenue increases would translate into wages, but a true hero was this black woman who came prepared with a pre-written question and asked our CEO what he was doing to change our culture for diversity and inclusion. We're a very white Midwest tech company. And he gave her a really mouthy, a mealy-mouth answer about unconscious bias training for HR. Chug Toad. That battle hymn was awesome. Great stuff. Uh-oh, Chongo, remember that? Terra and Maine from Korg, 7,000 BC. I don't know what you're talking about. Cuck Todd. Have you seen the National Review's list of top 10 party schools? No surprise to see Liberty and Oral Roberts on there, but I can't believe Prager U was number one. The Chris Lopako, have you talked about Mayor Pete and Jacob Wall yet? Oh, we forgot to do that.
I thought you did it on Wednesday.
We didn't get into it.
Oh, Brennan said you had.
Oh man, I just found out about that. It's so funny.
We got to do that again. We'll do it on Monday. Thick Mulvaney, I've had to take a break from filming on my last adult movie to request the banning of spanners in YouTube chat. Thanks. DX Fool, hey proletariats, regarding DSA members who used to write pieces for The Guardian, does Jamie have an update on Chelsea Manning? Last I heard, she was moved from solitary to the general population jail in Fairfax, Virginia. Do you think she'll be forced to testify in Assange's trial next year? Well, the reason why she's in prison is because she won't testify. Once the grand jury ends, she is out. Yeah. But that, who knows how long
she's
that
she's not going to do it. I don't have any special insider info, but I do not believe that she's going to crack. She's not going to do it.
Ryan in LA, the important question about Stephen Moore was, why the F was he CNN senior economic writer? Indeed. All right, we'll take four more of these. JJ Cool. Hey, Sam, do you think that it gets closer to the deadline for the primary voting? Progressive voters should coalesce behind one candidate to have any chance of winning? I think people should vote who they think is best. Chadu Stevens, Joe Biden gets it on with Dick Cheney. Ooh. Michael's tracksuit, feels good to be back. Teacher Harry, could I possibly get a show far for being a full MR subscriber and Patreon supporter and getting into law school? This feels, you got it. Three feels so much like 2019. I wake up every morning, squeal like I feel like I'm taking crazy pool pills. Michael, my girlfriend and I saw you in California. You're awesome. Keep the gulags alive. On a serious note, I want to say the way our city, New York, treats poor and immigrant children, welfare, education is disgusting, from de facto segregation to lead in the pipes. We need to fight it.
This is second point is very important, and I think I know who you guys are, and I will take particularly that your girlfriend's commitment to the gulag was very heartfelt and noted. Yes.
And the final IM of the day, of the week. It's a long one. Midwest is best.
Settling in.
I was in Milwaukee in 2016 working for Hillary with the unions. The unions, especially the public sector, had been hammered. This left me thinking that the Dems were going to need momentum to turn out their base, having lost the capacity to do so as much with the unions. I recently read a study about this, actually. This is that showed union density dropped about 7 points over the course of the five or six years of Scott Walker's legislation. And that accounted for at least I'm convinced that would have that accounted for her loss there. I mean, you're talking in Wisconsin, what was it, 11,000 votes or something like that?
We got to get the left and organized labor back on the same page, because they should be. Labor for Bernie is doing good stuff, I think.
I concluded that promising to continue with the Obama-era policies wasn't enough to turn voters out. With the election of Trump, a lot of leftists like myself are thinking that voters have to be offered change or a clear alternative to get the Democratic base to turn out in proper numbers to win. It seems the establishment has concluded that running against Trump may be enough now that he's actually in office. There certainly is many Democrats who are going to support Biden because they just want to go back to how it was, and maybe there's a more attractive option now that Trump has been in office. Starting to see shape up as a main disagreement among Democrats. On one hand, you have Democrats who think defeating Trump means going back to how things were. On the other hand, you have Democrats who think how things were is what created Trump. I think this will be a central theme in the debate for the presidential primary Democratic Party. Go back to normal or we'll change it. I think that's correct. But we shall see, starting with Monday.
Got to connect those dots. To get to where I want, but I know somehow I'm gonna get there. I wasn't looking when I just got caught between the truth and the light bulb. But finding out won't make me feel any better. Yeah, I know the clock is ticking, but the meds are gonna kick. Choice was made for the option where you don't get paid, for the road that bends before it finally breaks you. I guess somehow I lost my drive.